and gentlemen, it's Wednesday, the 15th day of June, 2016. Hillary literally is funded by Saudi Arabia, who runs ISIS. That's why anti-terrorism specialists aren't even allowed to investigate the mosque where the mass killer came from. Let's air this report from John Bowne, then we'll kick off the main transmission.
Career criminal mastermind Hillary Clinton wants your vote. So let's take a look at what is fueling her presidential campaign. Because a small percentage of shallow, misinformed voters will cast their vote for Hillary based on plastic values determined by her sex, her shallow political experience, and her hollow promises rather than the criminal indulgences Hillary has left in her wake as a corporatized public servant for the hijacked U.S. federal government. Hillary's New World Order cohort, President Obama, utilized the Hegelian dialectic to simply lie out of both sides of his mouth to get elected, racking up countless broken promises, a tactic Hillary wields with abandon. Currently, the latest hellhound on Hillary's trail is the fact that 20% of Hillary's campaign is funded by none other than the royal family of Saudi Arabia. That's right. Hillary is funded by those responsible for 9/11, the country that bought its way onto the United Nations Human Rights Council, while simultaneously beheading its own citizens, bringing the 2016 death toll to 95 as of June 2nd, 2016. Saudi Arabia has a legal system based on Sharia law with a Sharia law mole compromising a potential U.S. president in the form of the Muslim Brotherhood-linked Huma Abedin via her parents and her brothers. True to form, faux feminist Hillary wants to deflect the fact that the greatest woman-hating country on planet Earth is funding 20% of her campaign.
Good people will sit there and go to an interfaith gathering and hear women talk about how wonderful that Islam was the first to give women their rights, that Islam protects women. Islam, so listen to all these things that Islam is supposed to be good for women and just sit there and like baby birds when the mother bird feeds them, they drop the worm down the mouth.
Meanwhile, ISIS is selling six-year-olds into sex slavery and gets Saudi Arabian approval.
The problem is when you enter the world of Islam, you enter a world in which everything has two meanings and everything is upside down. And everything you think you know, it's the opposite of that. It's like Islam is permanent opposite day.
We and our allies must work hand in hand to dismantle the networks that move money and propaganda and arms and fighters around the world. We have to stem the flow of jihadists from Europe and America to Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, and then back again. The only way to do this is by working closely with our partners, strengthening our alliances, not weakening them or walking away from them.
Trump's words will be, in fact, they already are, a recruiting tool for ISIS to help them increase its ranks of people willing to do what we saw in Orlando. General Petraeus said recently that demonizing a religious faith and its adherents will come at a great cost, not just to our values, but to our men and women in uniform and our national security.
But Hillary knows who butters her globalist bread. Zero Hedge reports, as a reminder, it is illegal in the United States for foreign countries to try to influence the outcome of elections by funding candidates. That appears not to have stopped the Saudis, however. Saudi Arabian Prince Mohammed was quoted as saying, "Saudi Arabia always has sponsored both Republican and Democratic Party of America. And in America, current election also provide with full enthusiasm 20% of the cost of Hillary Clinton's election, even though some events in the country don't have a positive look to support the king of a woman for presidency." Forgive the bad English. The report did not remain on the website for long, although the Washington-based Institute for Gulf Affairs later republished an Arabic version of it, which quoted Prince Mohammed as having said Saudi Arabia had provided with full enthusiasm an undisclosed amount of money to Hillary Clinton. It's simple. A vote for Hillary is a vote for the continued slaughter and subjugation of American citizens under the emerging acceptance of Sharia law over the values expressed in the United States Constitution. It's really that simple. John Bowne for Infowars.com.
That is Veritas. Stay with us. I have talked to multiple individuals in the federal government, including people that have been at the scene of the shooting Saturday night in Orlando, Florida, who have told me directly that they're not even allowed to say the word radical Islam when they're doing investigations and questioning people. They're not even allowed to visit the mosque that he attended where the imam says, kill the gays. They are not even allowed to engage in any form of investigation. Then we see the media saying the FBI dropped the ball, the FBI did a terrible job, the FBI are a bunch of idiots. I'm not in the business of defending the FBI. Everybody knows that. I'm in the business of getting to the facts. And I've seen it over and over and over again with San Bernardino, with Fort Hood, with Orlando, with the Army, Navy, Marine Corps recruiting events, with the cop shot, with the guy screaming Allah Akbar on video in Philadelphia. On and on and on. Same story in Europe, but even worse, more events, where it's confirmed that Hollande, Merkel, Cameron, Barack Obama, then Attorney General, Eric Holder, Jed Johnson now, are all ordering federal investigators to basically stand down investigations. WorldNet Daily broke that with a whistleblower on Sunday. We wrote a story about it on Monday. DrudgeReport.com picked it up. And there are the witnesses to the fact that Hillary, still at the head of the State Department, blocked an investigation of the very mosque where this guy went. These people are allowed to go on TV. I played the clips probably 10 times. I can play it again. There's new ones today of this guy's imam saying, we kill the homosexuals for compassion. We must kill them is what we do. We just kill them. Here. Let's play it one more time. Let's go ahead and play it.
We have to have that compassion for people. With homosexuals, the same. Out of compassion, let's get rid of him now.
And again, that's the second half of the clip. Play the full clip. He says first, that we have to kill them out of compassion. Let's play that full clip for folks.
Death is the sentence. I mean, look, there's nothing to be embarrassed about this. Death is the sentence.
Hit pause, please. Death is the sentence. There's nothing to be embarrassed about that. That's what it is. Death is the sentence. So we do it out of compassion. We kill them. This guy is allowed to operate, and the FBI, counterterrorism forces, are not allowed to go interview him. Oh, and guess what's in the news today? Mr. Matin's daddy, that dresses up in military uniforms on YouTube and calls for the death of homosexuals, he has visited Barack Obama in the White House. Repeatedly. You cannot make this stuff up. You cannot make this bizarro land garbage up. We have a new video. It's up on DrudgeReport.com as well. The story's from Infowars.com, where the top Islamic speaker admits killing gays is a belief held by, quote, moderate Muslims. And it's a long clip. We're going to play it coming up. But first, just out of the gates, I want to play for you, instead of just reading these headlines, so it sinks in. We've heard Hillary, we've heard Bernie Sanders, we've heard Obama say ban semi-autos. Get some reasonable laws in place. You'll make them get licenses. The guy had a license. The guy worked as a subdivision of Homeland Security. His brother-in-law runs shipping in the jihadi refugees. UN Human Rights Chief says U.S. needs robust gun regulation. That's their response. CNS News. CBS News. Jed Johnson, the head of Homeland Security. Gun control is now a matter of Homeland Security. Yeah, it's outside of Congress. He'll do whatever he wants while they tell illegals of every type, just go ahead and skip your deportation hearing or your immigration hearing. And 90%+ just skip it. Nothing's ever done. Illegal immigrants who overstay visas almost never caught. Feds admit. Washington Times congressional report. It's all a total, complete joke. But we're told, oh, we're getting rid of all your freedoms and spying on you and coming after your guns to keep you safe when these are the authors of our peril. So we have a bunch of clips today. Obama says restrict guns to combat homegrown terror. Homegrown. He went to Saudi Arabia. His parents immigrated over here in the 80s, were Mujahideen, a.k.a. proto-Al-Qaeda. They're running around shooting their mouths off. The mosque, his dad, all these people. His brother-in-law is involved in anti-Trump activities and boycotts. Just like the Mexican judge, who's a La Raza member and wants open borders and is a globalist and is allied racially or nationally with a group, he shouldn't be ruling on Donald Trump matters because the guy is involved in a group boycotting Donald Trump. But they turn that into Donald Trump's racist. No, Donald Trump's a nationalist, and he's sick of people organizing themselves into religious and racial groups and attacking the country in gangs. That's what the KKK is. That's what La Raza is. That's what the Muslim Brotherhood is with the Hillary's girlfriend, one of the top honchos in that. This woman backs groups that don't want women outside without hoods over their head, but she prances around in Louis Vuitton $4,000 dresses and $5,000 handbags on TV, $2,000 shoes, hopping around red carpets, you know, loving on Hillary. What a sick joke. And then she's backing a group that keeps women as slaves because she's a slave master. Who's the number one bankroller of Hillary? Under Obama, it was Goldman Sachs. Under Hare Hillary, the Saudi Arabian government gives her 20% of her public campaign money. I mean, this is a group of just out-of-control lunatics. And now Hillary, more and more on the campaign trail, is just acting totally delusional and over-the-top confident and just gyrating and acting like a weird chicken or something. Just like, I mean, she is getting weirder and weirder and weirder and weirder. I mean, this is a fruitcake loon above the law, surrounded by smiling sycophants, kissing her diseased rump, and just letting her just run giant money laundering operations that make Iran-Contra look like child's play. And Iran-Contra was a takeout communist. And I'm against it because it was illegal and it grows into this type of illegal stuff. But it wasn't bringing Sharia law in and building hundreds of mosques in the U.S. These people are traitors. They are the plague. They are a disease. Can you guys pull me up the full quote of Cicero, the Roman senator, philosopher, historian about the traitor? Cicero's quote on the traitor. Or Cicero, the traitor is the plague, is how it ends. But first, let's just start getting into some clips. Let's go to Obama says restrict guns to combat homegrown terror. This is not homegrown. This is transplanted garbage. Here it is.
If we really want to help law enforcement protect Americans from homegrown extremists, the kind of tragedies that occurred at San Bernardino, and that now have occurred in Orlando. There is a meaningful way to do that. We have to make it harder for people who want to kill Americans to get their hands on weapons of war that let them kill dozens of innocents. It is absolutely true. We cannot prevent every tragedy, but we know that consistent with the Second Amendment, there are common sense steps that could reduce gun violence.
Total lies.
Could reduce the lethality of somebody who intends to do other people harm. We should give ATF the resources they need to enforce the gun laws that we already have. People with possible ties to terrorism who aren't allowed on a plane shouldn't be allowed to buy a gun.
All right, let's hit pause right there. I have to stop it. I have to talk through some of this. Let's back it up. Remember Rahm Emanuel when they were running for office in 2007, said to the handgun control group, he said, listen, we're going to put people on no-fly list, and then we can say they're on a no-gun buy list. Millions of people on no-fly list, they're innocent. No judge, no jury. You don't go after the real jihadis. You block the FBI from going after them in San Bernardino and in Florida and in every other case. You tie their hands. Then when there's an attack, you come out with the leftist press and blame them And then on top of it, you want to put everybody on a no-gun buy list where there's no judge, no jury, no nothing. The Southern Poverty Law Center, or ADL, just says so, and then magically you suddenly have your guns taken and can't buy guns anymore. He's saying, let's get rid of due process. Let's take the 68 Gun Control Act and say it doesn't just apply to felons. It applies to anybody we want, whenever we want. Outrageous. Ending due process is what he says to, quote, stop homegrown terrorist when it's not homegrown. It's transplanted. You've been protecting it. And the guy had special licenses and worked as an armed security guard to a big foreign British mercenary group that's heavily involved bringing the refugees in. Every level of what he says is a lie. So he says, quote, restrict guns to combat homegrown terror. We'll finish the clip as we go out to break. I'll come back with more. Here it is.
Enough talking about being tough on terrorism. Actually be tough on terrorism.
You know, that's enough. Back it up 15 seconds. We're going to go to break. We're going to come back with it. Enough talking about getting tough on terror. I told you, they bring the terrorist in, they protect the terrorist, they let them attack. When they attack, they blame our guns and due process and try to sew up what's left of American freedom. I mean, this is cut and dry. We were correct on target. Alex Jones here back live. Now, I want to be clear. Being right and sitting up here and saying our analysis was correct of what they were going to do with radical Islamic invasion, it's not about bragging and saying we were right. It's about pointing out, uh-oh, we're dead on. Our worst concerns and analysis have been confirmed. We better gear up to try to stop the next phase of this. They bring in the jihadis. They protect them. They allow them to start attacking. They activate with previous generation invasion forces. This is the way Islam works, especially the Wahhabist version of it, run out of Saudi Arabia. And then the client governments that have been bought off and paid off by these groups start saying, you've got to give up your free speech, you've got to give up your guns, you've got to give up your rights, you're the ones making Islam do this. Obama is on TV right now saying, we don't need to use this term radical Islam. Well, it's Orthodox Islam, period. This is what Islam is now. You could debate different periods of Islam or whatever, but it's very expansionist, it's very authoritarian, it's very anti-female, it's very anti-Western freedom, it's out of control, it's bought off our politicians. We're in deep trouble. It's infiltrated the security apparatus. I thought forever they were just letting some of these people attack because they wanted to get more of our rights and freedoms, but instead they're allowing a total takeover. And so we have people like the number one guy on Twitter, Milo Yiannopoulos, who's a gay conservative. That's the top story on Drudge Report. Gay Wars is the headline. Who has been banned from a speech that he was going to give today in Florida by the police. Police cancel Milo Yiannopoulos' Orlando speech on Muslims and gays. This is his speech, and the police canceled free speech in America. Over the top. Then there's this. Guess what? Now that he's been disappeared there, now they've disappeared him and his tens of millions of followers off of Twitter. Milo Yiannopoulos has been suspended from Twitter. The controversial conservative flamethrower was booted off the social network site Wednesday for reasons that have yet to be determined, though Milo has been under fierce attack from Muslims for his criticism of the left for choosing Islam over gays. That's because what he's saying is true. That's why they're so scared of it. And the police, don't you worry, have canceled him speaking, and now he gets to be kicked off Twitter and see people go, oh, well, that's fine, you know, kick him off. Oh, you'll be next. Then Drudge will be next. You see how that works? I told you, Europe arrests people by the thousands every week to criticize Islam, radical Islam, in any way online. We got video of people handing out flyers in Dresden just calling for sovereignty. They were being ticketed or arrested. It's on video. This is going on, and now it's here. And don't worry, though. They're not just going after your free speech. They're going after your guns, and they're going to make you comply. And Islam isn't going to stop attacking us. Every time Islam attacks, it'll be our fault. We didn't submit enough. We weren't politically correct enough. And even, you know, the protected group, the sacred cow of the gays, our media won't really report when they're throwing them by the thousands per city off roofs or chopping their heads off. They don't care about you. They just know that gays tend to give more money than any other group. Gay men and women give the number one amount overall of individual political contributions. Jews are number two. Just look it up in the metric. That's why they claim they care about you so much and want you to politically think they're your friends. They could care less about you. If you want to be a chump, keep being one, keep giving your money. But divorce lawyers lobbied for 20 years to get gay marriage in. It's so they can now get your property. Just, I mean, if you want to get suckered, you've really come to the right place with the New World Order. So I'm going to finish up with this Obama clip, come back, get to DHS secretary basically saying the same thing, that outside of law, they're coming for our guns. They mean business. But let's go ahead and play this clip of Obama.
Actually be tough on terrorism and stop making it easy as possible for terrorists to buy assault weapons.
Okay, he bought it legally.
Reinstate the assault weapons ban. Had make it harder for terrorists to use these weapons to kill us.
Had a registration.
Otherwise, despite extraordinary efforts across our government, by local law enforcement,
across our government,
by our intelligence agencies, by our military,
banning speeches,
all the sacrifices that folks make, these kinds of events are going to keep on happening.
That's right, he knows that.
And the weapons are only going to get more powerful.
Yeah, he knows the attacks are going to keep happening because he runs the Muslim Brotherhood with his cousin. He knows it's going to get bad because he's importing jihad and ordering the FBI and others to stand down so they can attack, because they're going to kill logic and take your free speech, my free speech, and our guns and everything else in the process. I predicted all of it. People said it doesn't make sense, though. They bring them in, they let them attack, then it's our fault? That's right. That's right. That's how this works. This is how they kill the free republic. Bringing incompatible people
the
in
on the
that work for the White House.
Alex Jones,
his dad went to the White House.
Radio Network.
Hell, Obama probably directed it. I almost want to play that Obama clip that we just played earlier one more time. It is only 2 minutes and 2 seconds long, and it is the most sickening, total disinformation I have ever heard in my life. In fact, I'm going to play it right now from the start, but stop and dissect each piece of it one more time. Let's cue that up, and then let's just go through it piece by piece, okay? So just be ready every few seconds to stop it. Go ahead and roll pure deception. Here it is.
If we really want to help law enforcement protect Americans from homegrown extremists.
Impossible. If we really want to help law enforcement protect us from homegrown extremists. Do you catch both the lies? They've been blocking law enforcement at every turn on record systematically with these mosques and coordinating with the mosque. There's a total pattern now. With the foreign governments financing it at the local level, but also at the national level, giving campaign money to Obama and Hillary and other Democrats. I mean, this is unprecedentedly evil. This is espionage. This is foreign infiltration. So, if we really want to help law enforcement stop homegrown extremists, this is not homegrown. This is foreign, financed, run, pledged allegiance to ISIS, directed by ISIS, part of the ISIS cult. It's like a way of life. It's directed. You buy into it, you get the book, you get the publications, you follow it. Total lies. And what, we're 8 seconds into it? How many seconds into the 2 minute clip are we? Yeah, 8 seconds in. Let's back it up again and just start from the beginning, and then I'll let it go forward. Just play it. Go ahead, please.
If we really want to help law enforcement protect Americans from homegrown extremists, the kind of tragedies that occurred at San Bernardino and that now have occurred in Orlando.
It paused. Let's go all the way. I'm going to start at the start, from the very start of the clip. San Bernardino and Orlando. I mean, we had Army, Navy, Marine Corps shooting. We had Fort Hood. We had all these others, and they won't say it's jihad there. And he's up there using what they have helped happen to go after the American people's sacred right that started the Revolutionary War in 1775, that was officiated in 1776, July 4th. That's what it's all about. They're striking at the heart of it. These vipers. I mean, this guy is such a viper. I mean, Just look at this guy. Look at him. I mean, it's Twilight Zone that our elite are this soft, even though they're corrupt, would put something this venomous in office that just wants to engage in the bizarre ritual of bringing in these horrible, filthy jihadis to then kill us and then blame us for it. Play it from the start.
If we really want to help law enforcement protect Americans from homegrown extremists, the kind of tragedies that occurred at San Bernardino and that now have occurred in Orlando, there is a meaningful way to do that. We have to make it harder for people who want to kill Americans to get their hands on weapons.
All right, pause. Back it up 10 seconds. I'm sorry, we had to do this as a whole college class. I could teach a one-year course on this two-minute, two-second clip. Seriously. Just analyzing. This is pure satanic lies. I mean, only the devil could string something together that is a pure lie from start to finish. He just said that if we want to stop this, we've got to have meaningful controls. When this guy worked for an international security company contracted by Homeland Security and is running around with licensed guns in New York and Florida and casing the joint, and co-workers are warning about him, threatening to kill people, but the boss is politically correct at the globalist security company, it's beyond that, and won't do anything, and the FBI comes twice and is ordered to stand down, and his imam is saying, kill gays. His father is on YouTube saying, kill gays. And then Obama blames the American people and the Second Amendment and lies and says that there was no background check and nothing was done to stop him. And at the end of the clip, threatens everyone cryptically and says there's going to be more of these and they're going to get bigger. Oh, we know you're going to have your people go into a school and kill 300 school kids. I just can see it. I've said nightclubs, schools, elementary kids, and then get ready. They're going to come out and blame John Wayne, folks. I'm telling you. I mean, Obama is really showing who he is here, folks. And to his constituents that may tune into the show, the Young Turks, people like that, I know you're on their payroll, but man, I guess you're a Young Turk. You're part of the alliance. Oh, I see. God almighty. We are in so much trouble. We are in so much trouble. But we deserve it. We've become so soft. I mean, we're just this bastion of freedom compared to other places. We've just been overrun with tyranny, overrun with aggressive civilizations that have been at war with themselves for thousands of years. And we just have no immune system to this. We are falling to every form of bullying. We are a broken, broken nation, like a prostitute. A $20 prostitute who's had cigarettes put out on her for 20 years and been beaten with coat hangers by her pimp. And finally, he's selling her off for $500 to guys that are going to film a snuff film with her. We're just being sent like an old horse to the Elmer's glue factory to be rendered down into glue. And presiding over it's this slimy, seedy, gross, fake creature that goes on all the entertainment shows and is worshipped by all the empty-headed, soulless yuppies. Let's continue with the pure deception.
There is a meaningful way to do that. We have to make it harder for people who want to kill Americans to get their hands on weapons of war that let them kill dozens of innocents. It is absolutely true. We cannot prevent every tragedy.
All right, back it up, 10. We, the American people, our right is allowing weapons of war to get to jihadis when he's funded jihadis all over the Middle East to overthrow countries and ship high-impact TOW missiles, Stinger missiles, anti-tank, anti-aircraft weapons to the people who are running around murdering Christians en masse by the hundreds of thousands. He and Hillary are openly shipping them the weapons. They're openly on the payroll. And then they turn around and say that we are giving jihadi weapons. No. And then we learn in Fast and Furious that they're shipping guns to Mexico to the jihadis. That's confirmed. So see, everything they're accusing us of is exactly what he's doing. If you invert what he's saying, we got our sleeper cells in place in America. There's a lot of attacks coming. Get ready for it. We're going to blame your Second Amendment, your free speech, and we're going to take everything you got. Submit to us. We're taking over. Let's continue.
Kill Americans to get their hands on weapons of war that let them kill dozens of innocents.
Hit pause again. You just heard the other line. He just said Americans. They have this guy from, what was it, Morocco, that stabbed two people to death yesterday. People he knew, liberals that trusted him. He came to their house, killed two Frenchmen, a man and a woman. And then the news said the Frenchman killed them, not the Islamists, the Frenchman. And now this guy hates America. This guy's parents, you know, came here, had him here. He's all hooked in bringing in refugees. He's not an American. He attacks Americans. He kills Americans. And then they turn it around and say, we can't let Americans get weapons of war. He won't say Islamicist. He'll say Americans. See, Obama goes further than just not letting us say it's Islam or even radical Islam. He says it's America that did this. It's the guns that did this. You did this. I did this. I mean, this is so evil. They sit down with the speechwriters and they write this stuff, just shoveling it at you. And all the leftists go on their Facebook walls and they run around on their different websites and they go, Alex, are you proud of yourself now? And emails I've got. You Americans with your guns. When are you going to stop it? Whoa. Here's the guy allowing all this to happen, ordering the FBI to stand down on record. Why is that imam not arrested of his church? Going, we must kill them. We must execute the gays, the homosexuals. It's the compassionate thing to do. You do it. We do not apologize. He's saying go kill people. That's not free speech. That's a call to action. But that's okay, because the FBI and anti-terrorism forces were officially told. I've talked to the sources. You're not allowed to even ask about Islam in your investigation because this is an Islam that happened. Oh, and then witnesses, victims, we've interviewed two of them, saw multiple shooters. And guess what they're now saying? They're taking down the Facebook pages of people that say that. And there's liberal outrage. How dare you imply this was an organized Islamic plot? How dare you? Our cult leader said it wasn't. It was America's fault. He said so. I mean, what is it we won't put up with? You're in a cult, folks, if you follow this. I'm not talking to our main audience. I'm talking to the cult members. Let's finish up the clip. There's so many lies in the verbiage, you know, in the words being used. It's dizzying. It's dizzying. Here it is.
It is absolutely true. We cannot prevent every tragedy. But we know that, consistent with the Second Amendment, there are common sense steps that could reduce gun violence and could reduce the lethality.
Hit pause. None of them are common sense. All the stuff they want's already in place. They keep acting like it wasn't. They keep acting like he didn't have a license. They keep acting like he wasn't hooked into Homeland Security. They keep acting like his dad didn't visit the White House. They keep acting like his brother doesn't work with contractors and Homeland Security, bringing in more jihadis. They keep acting like they're not protecting the mosque. They keep acting like all of this. Again, just, we need some common sense. Come on, America. We had Americans. We had an American do this. Americans are doing some bad stuff. We just need to take their guns and their speech. And you got Milo Yiannopoulos, who had the most Twitter followers out there. Just a gargantuan number. And he's going to give a speech in Orlando, and he's banned. I've had the ACLU ask me to become a co-signer in a lawsuit, to be able to even speak and get a public permit in Cleveland to defend free speech. They won't even give Roger Stone and the group I'm involved in the permit. So they say you can meet for 1 hour, 5 miles away behind a building in some free speech zone. So Cleveland to ban Trump supporters outside RNC. This is the same formula you're seeing in Europe. It's here. Now, there's so many lies, I got to just finish the clip, but the threat's coming up. Here it is.
Of somebody who intends to do other people harm. We should give ATF the resources they need to enforce the gun laws that we already have.
Expand the gun grabbers.
People with possible ties to terrorism who aren't allowed on a plane.
Yeah, get rid of due process.
Shouldn't be allowed to buy a gun.
Just got to work for Homeland Security.
Enough talking about being tough on terrorism.
All right, actually be tough. Oh, yeah. Quit talking about being tough. Actually be tough and help fund Al-Qaeda, now known as ISIS, to invade all these countries and overthrow our allies in Egypt and other areas. This is incredible. This guy is running an Islamic jihad invasion into our country. He went to madrasas as a child. He is literally attacking our nation. Literally. You can say he's the head of Al-Qaeda in the United States. He is. He is funding it. He is protecting it. I talked to federal sources. They said, no, absolutely. We know. We know Hillary is on their payroll. We know they're getting funding from the same group that funds ISIS. We know. We are literally ordered to do nothing. Oh, but they want to pass more laws, taking more of our liberties to use it against the American people. Let's finish the clip. Here's the threat.
Actually be tough on terrorism and stop making it easy as possible for terrorists to buy assault weapons.
Okay. Terrorist.
Reinstate the assault weapons ban. Make it harder for terrorists to use these weapons to kill us.
Ban the guns.
Otherwise, despite extraordinary efforts across our government, by local law enforcement, by our intelligence agencies, by our military, despite all the sacrifices that folks make, these kinds of events are going to keep on happening. And the weapons are only going to get more powerful.
Oh, yeah, I bet you're cooking something up big, brother. It's a very dangerous time to be alive, folks. They're making their move. This is the attempted takedown of America. God help us. I've never seen anything this naked, anything this brazen, anything this deceptive. This is truly sickening. Let me stop right there. We need to take it in our own hands to be healthy. We need to take it in our own hands to be prepared. And one of the biggest things folks can do is take Living Defense Harmful Organism Cleanse. It's 120 capsules. It's a big bottle. It's 27 ingredients of known herbs and known compounds that will knock out bad parasites across the spectrum, from wild-crafted black walnut greenhull to organic wormwood. That's why they called it wormwood. You took the wood to get rid of worms. And it just goes on through all the known ingredients that are also good for you on so many other fronts. This is really just a super health pill, but it's got things in it that the little garbage operators don't like. I've started a six-week cleanse. I'm taking a low dose of it, of just one pill a day. Has really worked good for me. It's the second time I've done it. This sold out in 2 days when we got the first run. This run was three times bigger, but it is shelling out. It will be completely sold out by Friday or Sunday at current rates. We're not doing the special anymore, 20% off. But it's still well worth it, and the profit we make is needed to fund this operation. And this is something definitely everybody should certainly do. Also, DNA Force has been sold out. It is now back in stock. Again, DNA Force is now back in stock. Deep research, patented ingredients, difficult to source. That is the most powerful product we have. It is nutraceutical grade. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. And also, we have 20% off all Alexa Pure water filtration systems at InfoWarsStore.com. You get free shipping on all orders, $50 or more, and you get 10% off additional on any item you get auto ship on, like organic coffee or the different supplements. Be sure and check out the 10% off on those that sign up for auto ship and the free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. Stay with us. We're going to play more gun grab clips. I spent a good 25 minutes on that one Obama clip just to analyze how it's all pure lies and all total deception. And quite frankly, there's a bunch of other lies I didn't even address because everything he said was a 360 lie. It was just pure, perfect deception. And that's the key to their operations, is just get everybody basically enveloped in a total lie where the whole universe is an artificial fraud. Notice he said, we've got to stop the violence. Well, Matt just popped in my ear during the break and he said, what about arming people? What about people in the nightclub being armed? What about the idea of there not being a three-hour SWAT team response? Exactly. And then what about stopping the violence, not letting this jihadi operate and threaten people? But his coworkers wouldn't report him, even though he threatened to kill people, because he was Muslim and that'd be politically incorrect. Well, no, the big British Merck company he works for seems to only hire Muslims to run security, from airport security to you name it. Why don't we just hire child molesters to run all the daycares in America? I mean, why don't we hire foxes to guard hen houses? Tim Kennedy, counterterrorism expert, and I'm just going to leave it at that, okay? He's just high-level counterterrorism, as you're going to get. That's what he does in the Army. I'm just going to stop right there. He's going to give you what he can tell you on what's really happening from his sources, and I also have sources that I'm going to bounce off of him and see what he can say. But he concurred with me this morning, there is a total stand-down. Total stand-down. They know who the groups are. They're all over the place. And they are getting ready. That's why Obama looks at the camera and he said, there will be more and it will be worse. That was an open threat. You give us your guns, you give us your speech, or the Muslim terror cells are going to activate. We are now under Islamic jihad terror rule in America. And don't think the Republicans, when they get in, unless it's Donald Trump, are going to stop this. They love it. They love the death of logic where I get shut off the radio because I'm talking about this. That's happening on some stations. Or Milo gets kicked off and the police can't cancel his speaking event, saying it's not safe because the Muslims might attack it. I mean, this is dangerous, dangerous. This is the death of our country. And I mean, I'm serious. I hope all the leftists and people are proud of what you've done. My God, you people are the most unliberal trash I've ever imagined in my life. Keeping more of my money, living my own life, being able to defend myself, being able to make my own choices, that's liberal. Liberal means open, not banning words, not attacking families, not allying with jihadis. Marcus Tullius Cicero said, a nation can survive its fools, and even the ambitious, but it cannot survive treason from within. An enemy of the gates is less formidable, for he is known and carries his banner openly. But the traitor moves amongst those within the gate freely. His sly whispers, rustling through all the alleyways, heard in the very halls of government itself. For the traitor appears and not a traitor. He speaks in accents familiar to his victims, and he wears their face and their arguments. He appeals to the baseness that lies deep within the hearts of all men. He rots the soul of a nation. He works secretly and unknown in the night to undermine the pillars of the city. He infects the body politic so that it can no longer resist. A murderer is less to fear. The traitor is the plague. The traitor is the plague. And this quote doesn't even finish that part. But you notice we Googled it. That's what it came up with. The traitor is the plague. The traitor. The traitor. The traitor. The traitor. But Obama's not a traitor. His people are traitors, those that go along with him. Even if you know the orders are wrong, but you follow them, you're not a bad person, you're still a traitor. Obama is the infiltrator. The infiltrator. I wish this country just wake up.
Did what he had to do.
Because now I can see the enemy plan just clear as day. I saw it afar off.
And
I was dead on. That's not a good feeling. I wish I'd been wrong all along. And as we got closer to the globalist takeover and their endgame, it just becomes crystal, absolutely clear. We can see the areas we were wrong about, didn't quite get exactly right. I'll tell you what's crazy. It's always worse than we thought. Reality is so fantastical, the good, the bad, and the ugly, that when you look at the bad and you're a person that wants to be good, it's just hard to believe. And so I understand why people are in denial. Because you just want to have a good job and a good family and, you know, enjoy life and experience the beauty and love God and Then you see the globalists that want to dominate and control and all the bad stuff they do. And you hear about the UN every week running giant child kidnapping rings and every other form of evil you can imagine. And nothing's even done to them. And you just say, it can't be true. Or you say, well, what am I going to do? We've got to expose these people. We've got to stop complying with them. And we've got to give support to those that tell the truth and fight back against evil. Now, I want to play one more of these Homeland Security clips before Tim Kennedy comes in at the start of the next segment. I want to play DHS Director J. Johnson, says passing gun control is now part and parcel of Homeland Security. And he's also implying we're just going to do this extrajudicially, as Obama has said he'll do with the executive orders. So they're saying the answer to keeping us safe is taking our guns while the government buys more and more guns to protect itself and protects the jihadis. And Jed Johnson is protecting the jihadis. It's a fact. Here it is.
I do believe, however, that meaningful, responsible gun control is now part and parcel of Homeland Security. It's critical to public safety, but we have to face the fact that meaningful, responsible gun control has to be part of Homeland Security as well, given the prospect of homegrown, homeborn violent extremism in this country. We've seen this now with Orlando, tragically, with San Bernardino. And it's something that I think the American public and the Congress has to face and has to address.
And if they're on a watch list, should they be able to buy an assault weapon?
Well, a number of people have made the point that individuals who are on our no-fly list, who are on various other lists, who are able to purchase a weapon in this country. I believe that that's something that has to be addressed. I think that those of us in the executive branch and in the legislative branch have to face this.
With great respect, Mr. Secretary, you are head of Homeland Security. What do you think?
I believe that meaningful, responsible gun control is part of Homeland Security, and it's something we have to address.
All right, that's enough. So basically, that's the line. Oh, we just, if you're on a no-fly list, the magic no-fly list that has millions of innocent people on it, that no one knows how you get on, a secret list, then you can't own a gun, and you have to turn your guns in, and you can't buy guns. Meanwhile, this guy worked for one of the biggest merc groups in the world, doing really cruddy jobs all over the planet, reportedly, that's full of Muslims. That's their specialty. They were protecting him, shooting his mouth off, threatening coworkers to kill him. But, you know, that he works with Al-Qaeda, works with ISIS. The FBI had their hands tied. He has a gun license, all this. That guy's not going to be on a no-fly list. Hell, they don't put known terrorists on there. It's a no-travel list. It's an internal checkpoint system. The IRS wants it where if they open an investigation on you, you can't even get on a plane domestically. They already have it where you can't leave the country. They're clamping down on us. They're banning our free speech. They're coming after our guns. It's cut and dry. And America must stand up and say, we know you're working with the terrorists. We know you're allied with them, criminals. All right, Tim Kennedy is with us for the rest of the hour. And the reason Tim Kennedy's here is I've gotten to know him in the last year or so. I went to high school with one of his best friends, Shane Steiner. And, you know, Shane's been involved in our shooting shows and stuff we do just because he's a friend and I like him and, you know, we're fellow shooters. And then over the last few years, he's like, man, you ought to meet Tim Kennedy. He's really awesome. You know, come over to the house or whatever when he's going to have dinner. And I just was always too busy, never did. But the last 6 months or so, we started hanging out quite a bit. And, of course, I knew the guy was a Special Forces soldier. I knew he was one of the top UFC fighters and, you know, all the rest of it. But I just was so busy, really didn't follow it. But getting to know him and all the anti-terrorism background, the rest of it, obviously with all this new stuff that's been happening, it was like perfect timing. Unfortunately for the country, but fortunately for us here on the show to have your basic, you know, bird's eye view and also on the ground view of what's unfolding. If stations just joined us, as some stations only carry the second and third hour, the head of Homeland Security has come out. Obama has come out, and they said they want a no-buy list for gun owners, extrajudicial, extra-legislative. 2 million Americans on the no-fly list, most of them totally innocent. Suddenly you can't buy a gun because the administration puts you on a list. This is the end of judicial review. It's the end of due process. It's unspeakable. Now, remember, this was their goal in 2008 during the campaign. Rahm Emanuel, who became the White House Chief of Staff, gave speeches saying, if you are on a list of maybe being a possible terrorist, you don't have a right to own guns. So They want to just put you on a magic list and use Homeland Security to take your guns. Now, Obama went on, we're going to play this clip again in a moment, and said there's going to be bigger attacks and you better just let us restrict your guns. And he said, because we've got to stop American terrorists. So you can't say Islamic. The FBI says they're not allowed to even say that. We're told this isn't Islamic. We're told to stand down. The mosque is protected. The imam can say kill the gays. We're going to play these clips. Other imams can. His dad can say it. But it's not Islamic. No, it's American gun owners. We have the clip. I played it last hour where Obama openly says it. You cannot make this up. So, Tim Kennedy, I know you're chomping at the bit to talk about this. We played a clip that you shot on June 1st of these vignettes we were going to dole out over the next month. But we went ahead and played it yesterday, a few weeks early, really, because you said, look, political correctness will get you killed. We're about to have jihad attacks in this country. You need to get prepared. You need to get ready. Wow. I tell you, I mean, where should we start first?
You don't want to be right about these things. You don't. I was heartbroken. I was disappointed. I was depressed. It was saddened. It broke my heart to see that I was right. I didn't want Americans to die. I don't want anybody to die. And now that Americans have died, regardless of what their sexual orientation, what their religion is, those are Americans that were murdered in a nightclub by radical Islam. So radical Islam murdered 49 people.
Let's just say it. He didn't want us to say radical Islam. Islam.
Radicalized by an imam. So essentially a pastor in a church said, hey, you guys be crazy and go kill people we don't like. But we now, the Americans, are going to have to face the consequences of a very small group of fanatics. They're not going to try to take their guns. They're not. It has been very obvious for the past 7 years that they don't go after them. They leave them alone. They say, don't go after the imams. Don't even say Islam. Don't even say Muslim. Don't say radical extremist. Just look for any excuse to try to take guns. Now, the people's guns that they're going to take are not going to be theirs. They're criminals are always going to be get guns.
This guy had a Homeland Security clearance and his brother-in-law ships the jihadis in.
So, you know, if you want to, let's just say we're going to make drugs illegal, then we wouldn't have any drugs, right? Wait, no, that doesn't work. Obviously, we still can get anything that you want on the street. You know, you can get cocaine, you can get heroin, you can get marijuana at any 7-Eleven. So outlawing it at this point, when we have the number, the millions and tons, hundreds of millions of guns that we have here, is not going to change anything. So
sure, we know they're coming after the American people, though.
Yeah, they're going to come after us. They're not going to go after the Muslim extremists. They're going to leave them alone, and they're going to try to take our guns. My guns, Alex's guns, Shane's guns, every true patriot's guns.
And now it's pretty clear. We talked about this when you were in here Sunday. We talked about it last week. What is the master motive? We've seen it in Europe. Now it's here. Bring them in. Let them attack. Protect them. Order the FBI to stand down. And then now Milo, the top guy on Twitter, the police banned his speech today in Florida because of threats. And now he's been kicked off Twitter because he's pointing out that Islam says it's going to kill all the gays. He has his speech taken now for these people. My God, I mean, 20% of Hillary's campaign money is from Saudi Arabia. That's the folks that fund ISIS.
There's no question. You can't. So if you look at all the places around the world where being gay is illegal, it's Muslim countries. It's not the West. It's not Europe. It's Muslim countries where.
But the left won't let you say that.
No, but that's the truth. That's the thing about the truth is you can't hide it. Just Google it right now. Go and say, what countries is it illegal to be gay? Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Iraq, Afghanistan. Those are the countries. Those are the countries that they push them off of roofs. I'm saying this is America. You do whatever you want. That's the point of being free. We're about to lose those freedoms. Oh, there we go. Look, which countries?
77 countries. And the ones where they execute you, the 11 are Muslim. But expanding on that, instead, the left wants to indoctrinate our kids when we're saying, no, we're the parents. You have freedom, but I have freedom for you not to indoctrinate me or my kids. That's why they're mad at us, because a lot of these leftist groups want to take over politically. And that's why they're allied with Islam, because it's totalitarian.
Yeah. The only way that we can fight this is we start getting strong individually. Like, we cannot be weak. We cannot be a weak.
And we have to unbrainwash our kids and be aware and not just give into this culture. Fight against it, which will actually make us stronger.
Yeah, right now, we are being sheep led to the slaughter. The media comes on and tells us whatever we want. And we're like, oh, okay, I guess guns are bad. Because look, it just killed a bunch of gay people in Orlando. No, radical Islam did that. The gun had nothing to do with it. And
from your sources, in and around anti-terrorism, 3-hour stand down of the SWAT team. How did that happen?
So it wasn't a stand down. What happened was these are regular police officers. They worked their shifts and now they're at home, right? They're at home, they're asleep, they're with their kids. They have their pagers, they have their cell phones. When a shooting started happening at a club, they didn't know what it was right away. So it took a while, almost an hour, for it to be an active shooter at a nightclub. So now it's activating SWAT. We're an hour into it. Now,
sure. Shouldn't we just have the regular officers be ordered to storm facilities like that? If you want to be a cop, yeah. I mean, the old days, they just storm stuff.
So absolutely. Right now, I train people active shooter response. It takes one gun to change the chemistry of a gunfight. One person with a gun. So if there's a guy walking around just executing people,
you're going to pin him down.
It changes everything about the gunfight.
Well, let's say you were down the street and heard the shots or heard this was happening, or you were on duty. I know all your family are cops, and you're driving along, you hear shots fired. What does Tim Kennedy do?
You run towards gunfire. First time I was in Iraq, I'm on a Black Hawk, and we're flying in, brown out. The dust is getting kicked up. And all I see is these flashes from the top of a roof. It was muzzle fire, and rounds were coming at us. And I'm an E5, brand new to Special Forces. And I start running towards the flashes because I knew that was gunfire. I didn't know if I was doing the right thing. I looked to my left and right. All 12 of my brothers are to my left and right, and where everybody's doing the same thing, we're running towards gunfire because that's what you do. That's how you save lives. The longer you let them shoot you, the more of your dudes are going to die. The faster you get rounds on them, the quicker you save lives.
And I mean, the tower shooting, that's what everybody did. I mean, the citizens started firing on the guys. How do we go from that culture to this?
Being in villages in Afghanistan and Pakistan where you see the Taliban walk in and just start effortlessly executing people. When one person in the village shoots back, they are cowards. They're not like cowards. They are gutless, impotent pussies. And these guys, it takes one person to start shooting back and they start running. One person, not even accurate fire. But if you put a trained person at that nightclub that says, no, not tonight, I'm not going to let my...
Well, imagine what would have happened in Texas. I mean, this person...
You don't have to imagine.
Gay nightclub or not, this guy's dead in about a minute.
No, we don't have to imagine because it's already happened. Garland, Texas, last year, we had two radicalized Islam guys drive into town.
And they were going to go into a community center and kill everybody. It didn't happen.
It was a plan. They already said there was a plan. They had been activated and they were going to go in. They had guns to do it. They drive into the parking lot and they're going to go kill a bunch of Texans. They didn't make it out of their car. They were killed in their car. They fell out like Swiss cheese.
Instead, imagine if that had been somewhere where it was a bunch of liberals. My God, they could have killed hundreds.
So there were two shooters in San Bernardino and there were no people with guns. That's the difference.
You know, this Muslim that killed his friends that were French, he knew them and went to their house to kill them. It seems like they like to kill people they know. It's San Bernardino. These were their coworkers, people they had like Christmas parties with.
There's no connection. If you're not of shared faith, if you're not Muslim, if you don't pray with them, you're nothing to them. There is no connection. They will kill you. They will kill your kids. They'll behead you. They'll throw you off roofs. They'll do anything that they can to end you because you are against what they stand for. That's Islam. Doesn't matter who you are or how you know them. They will kill you.
You heard us report from our sources on the six cities that are targets. Talking to your sources, was that accurate?
Yeah. So we know that there had been other guys that were radicalized. And so... Omar Martin was one in 2014. The guy that went to Syria and blew himself up was another. There's a handful of other guys, and we don't know where they are. They are being actively pursued, whether it's going to be New Orleans, where the gay parade is going to be happening this weekend. You watch yourselves. You be sheepdogs and have your heads on swivels. San Francisco, New York, Boston, you know, major metropolitan cities with culture. They hate it. They want it to be wiped off the face of the planet.
And then the weirdo leftists want to control all culture and they're allied with it. This is mental illness. I mean, this is crazy town.
It's lethal. It's to a point, it's beyond crazy where they're actually seemingly enabling these people to kill us. It's past crazy. It's intentional.
Let's talk about the latest developments and how they want to extrajudicially get rid of your Second Amendment and Obama or anybody just put you on a secret list and your guns are taken while they coddle the terrorists. Tim Kennedy's my guest. I do intend to open the phones up when we start the next hour. There is so much to get to here, but I cannot find words, Tim, to describe how over the top it is. In the next segment, we're going to play some of this, where they're banning people giving speeches like Milo Yiannopoulos, the police are, in Florida, and kicking him off Twitter because he simply is going to point out that Islam is attacking gays, and he has 30 million followers or whatever on Twitter. And then meanwhile, we're going to play this clip in the next segment. Islamic speaker admits killing gays is a belief held by moderate Muslims. Where do you expect all this to go? Will the narrative Obama's selling of blaming the Second Amendment, will that work?
Yeah, well, it'll work for him. So right now, the only time the Constitution applies is when it's convenient for them. So, you know, First Amendment, like that, freedom of speech, that's cool. Unless it's when you're saying things that we or the media doesn't like. Then we're just going to outlaw you. We're going to block you. We're going to reject your social media presence. We're going to delete your accounts. We're going to suspend you. Or we'll even fine you and charge you with crimes. That's what they're doing. It's going to be the exact same thing with the Second Amendment. Yeah, it's great for them to have guns, for Hillary to be surrounded with people with guns so she's safe, just like Obama is surrounded by guns, just like Biden's surrounded by guns. But we're not allowed to have them because it's not convenient for them. And it's going to be the same way with every single one of our beautiful amendments until we have no rights and they have all of them. That's coming.
Look at this. This is out of CNS News. UN Human Rights Chief, that's the United Nations, says U.S. needs robust gun regulation, close quote. And the head of Homeland Security agrees. He says we're going to get those guns. And Obama said, quote, American terrorism is why we need more gun laws, when this guy followed all the laws.
Yeah.
Do you think that's going to be successful?
I don't care. Can you give me one example of when the UN has done something that made sense? That has done something that was in the interest of the United States? One.
What is the military, the active duty folks you talk to, what is their view right now of how bizarre this is getting? Because quite frankly, I've been on here 21 years, Tim, and I'm really having trouble dealing with this because this has just gotten so Alice in Wonderland.
It's frustration. You know, the things that I'm saying is being, you know, that's a representation, embodiment, I think, of a culture, a group of Americans, of patriots that raised their right hand and swore to protect the Constitution against foreign and domestic enemies. And right now we have those enemies both domestically and foreign. Like we are at war right now for our freedoms, both here and abroad.
It's paradoxical because they're undermining the military and the culture. But at the same time, it's the military that's helping them project their power and control, like trying to put women in frontline special forces positions, but lowering the standards and admitting they're lowering the standards.
I said it, you know, we released that video yesterday about political correctness. It goes deeper than that. You know, it's not just the words. The words are one thing where we shouldn't say things like radical Islam. We shouldn't say things like Muslims are killing gays, because they are. It is to a point where we're saying we don't even need to have unique specialized units. We're going to water them down and dilute them. So we have the solution, because dilution is a solution, apparently, of political correctness, of gender equality. So gender equality it's a hot word. You know, it's the thing to do. It's the thing to say, and it's the thing to support. While I believe that women should have access to every unit there is, it has to be done correctly. And the wrong way is to drop and lower our standards.
But you can't go have a baby. This idea that, you know, maybe 1 out of 1,000 guys could be in the more elite Army units or Navy units. And then meanwhile, I mean, it's like saying I'm going to be a long distance runner and beat a bunch of Kenyans. It just isn't reality based. I can't go have a baby. I don't have a uterus. So it's okay that not everybody's Tim Kennedy, and we can't expect to force the military to put women in those positions. It's insane.
Yeah, the clearest demonstration I'd ever seen, I didn't even understand it or realize it at the time. I was watching the CrossFit Games, and they had this event where you had to climb a pegboard. So they had this piece of wood up the wall, and you have these pegs in your hand. You have to climb up this wall. And when you get to the top, it's not an easy thing to do. We had it in our wrestling room, both in high school and college, and we had to do it every single day. So it's something that wrestlers are really used to, gymnast guys are really used to. And then as soon as you get off the wall, you get on the rower and you had to roll 1,000 meters. They had 10 male athletes. All 10 male athletes got up the pegboard, got down to the bottom, and then rowed their 1,000 within the designated time. They had 10 women that tried it. One woman actually made it to the rower, and she didn't even complete the row in time. And these are the most elite athletes on the planet, and they couldn't even do...
Sure, I mean, it's crazy. It's like putting me in the ring with Mike Tyson at his prime. It's two different people, two different physiologies. Well, it's even more dramatic with a woman. I mean, they've got a uterus. We'll be back. I'm sorry. They have a uterus. They have mammary glands.
Alex Jones.
They're a woman.
GCN Radio.
I think they're magic. I mean, I can't do stuff they do. We'll be back. I want to go through some of these clips since we mentioned them. The first clip is obviously what we've been playing a lot of before I play this new one. This is the imam at his mosque there in Orlando, who in English says we need to execute them. We need, you know, the penalty is death. We need to kill the homosexuals. This is the compassionate thing to do. Here's that clip.
Death is the sentence. I mean, look, there's nothing to be embarrassed about this. That death is the sentence. We have to have that compassion for people.
But he can go around.
With homosexuals, the same.
Apparently, that's fine for him to say. That's his right under the First Amendment.
Every time we have a conference, every time we invite a speaker, they always can come with the same accusations.
Here's another one.
This speaker supports death penalty for homosexuals. This speaker supports death penalty for this crime or this crime or that. He is homophobic. They subjugate women, etc., etc., etc.
It's they the do, same. And they are.
Old stuff coming all the time. And we always try to tell them, I always try to tell them that, look, it's not that speaker that we're inviting who has these extreme radical views, as you say. These are general views that every Muslim actually has. Every Muslim believes in these things. Just because they're not telling you about it, or just because they're not out there in the media, doesn't mean they don't believe in them. So I will ask you, everyone in the room, how many of you are normal Muslims? You're not extremist, you're not radical, just normal Sunni Muslims. Please raise your hands. Everybody, mashallah.
Seen this.
Subhanallah. Okay, take down your hands again.
Scary.
How many of you agree that men and women should sit separate? Please raise your hands. Everyone agree.
Our government's bringing these people in while putting tranny bathrooms over.
It's not just these radical sheikhs then.
Talk about explosive.
Let's go to the bathroom together.
How many of you
can't even sit together?
That the punishments described in the Quran and the Sunnah, whether it is death, whether it is stoning for adultery,
look
whatever
it is. Look what whack jobs
is,
these people are.
If it is
they just look like a bunch of soft idiots.
The references of the scripture that he just said are specifically about homosexuals and women that have sex out of marriage.
And that is
let's
what
kill
we
them.
Should
that's what he just said. Stone
the
them?
Well, who agrees with that?
And then Obama's running around blaming the Second
Allah
Amendment.
Are you all radical extremists? SubhanAllah. So all of you are saying that you are common Muslims, you all go to the different masajids, no way. Or is it, are you like a specific sect, like the Islam net sect or anything like that? Are you like that? No. Is it, are you like that? Please raise your hand if you like this extreme Islam net sect or anything like that. No one. Allahu Akbar. How many of you just go to these normal masajids in Norway?
Look, I can't see anymore. I've seen this before. Just that's good. This is what their mainline speakers are pushing, and he's organizing basically brigades of people saying, I'm ready to kill. I'm ready to kill women who aren't married, who have a boyfriend. I'm ready to kill anyone that is homosexual. I'm ready to kill. And then they let them do this, but Milo, who's a conservative gay activist and a Breitbart technology editor with, what is it, 30 million Twitter followers, whatever, he's been suspended, disappeared. He and the police have said he can't have his speech today. I mean, wow. And then Obama is up here lecturing us not to criticize Islam. I mean, this is crazy, Tim Kennedy.
That's not crazy. This is planned. This is orchestrated. What we saw there was moderate Muslims saying that they want to kill gays. That if you have sex outside of marriage, that you have to be stoned to death. that this and to have those beliefs is normal. That is not radical. That is not extreme. That is at the core of who and what they are.
No, I agree. But I say it's crazy for us to put up with it. So let me ask you the question. What is the larger plan? What is the calculus in the best thinking in anti-terrorism circles of why Homeland Security is doing this?
To take our freedoms. You can't just say, hey, take those guys' guns. What you can say is, oh my goodness, a whole bunch of Americans were just murdered and they used this gun. So let's outlaw that gun. And then let's try to find some people, some groups, some sects that we don't agree with, and let's take their guns. Because that's the radical, that's the logical, that's the rational thing to do. And so then slowly our freedoms are eroded bit by bit. You know, it's not going to be an overnight thing because we'll feel it and we'll notice it and we'll fight that. It's going to be small incremental freedoms taken time and time and time again. And then you're not going to know, you're not going to realize how far down that path of complete control they have until you look back and see how many small steps you've taken. Lots of little steps, a lot of little steps away from freedom. And then you look back and there's no way for us to get back there because too much has been lost. Too much ground has been lost.
Dead on, dead on. And meanwhile, Academy Sporting Goods, where I bought firearms, is banning, I guess, what, the AR-15, the M4, the 223. I mean, what is going on here?
That was an American, or that was an American company, Texas-based, Texas-founded, and now they are having to give in to the whims of culture, the pressure, because they're scared of the repercussions.
And they're creating an ammo database. I'm sorry, it's even worse. They're now tracking gun owners after we're already tracked like we're criminals.
Yeah.
Bye-bye, Academy. I'm never walking in there again.
Yeah.
Tim, we really should boycott them.
Scary.
I mean, how do we get them to correct their behavior?
You know, so again, back to the idea of kind of what a patriot is, what a true patriot is, the things that we're providing people all the time. You can vote with your dollars. You know, I don't go to Starbucks because you're not allowed to carry a concealed weapon there and they have crappy coffee. So guess what? They don't get my shirt. They don't get my business ever. I don't care if I'm about to fall asleep at the wheel. I'll go to a 7-Eleven or a Dunkin' Donuts to get coffee before I walk into there. So I vote with my dollars. It's going to be the exact same thing. We have to do that. We as a community, as a culture, as a group, me and my friends, we talk about these things. This is part of being a patriot.
Like, that's right. You support media and institutions that are pro-liberty, and you absolutely do not support globalist organizations.
Every chance I get. And I love it, like, oh, this new place is going to be opening a Transformers bathroom, and they're, you know, my daughters, my 12 and 13-year-old daughters are going to maybe be in there with somebody that is not a female. So I don't shop there.
Alamo Drafthouse is building a great movie theater. I've known the owner since he founded it. He's super liberal. They're building their new super center, and it has one giant bathroom. They put the designs on Facebook where you go in with men and women. Now, it has some individual stalls, but other than that, it has a transsexual urinals for men and women. So women will now turn around and squat into a urinal in front of men. I mean, this is mental illness. And what's going to happen when the Muslims go in there? They're going to flip out.
Yeah. That's this contradiction. So like this idea of decorum and political correctness and propriety, it's absolutely lost now.
It's about degrading us. It's about dominating
us. It is. But then we're embracing this culture that wants to kill us. And if you send an Islam or Muslim person into that bathroom, they will hurt Americans because it's offensive to them. But then we're pushing that. We're saying, no, you have to build your bathrooms, your restaurants, your movie theaters this way because that's the political correct thing to do. It will get people killed.
You can find the...
Don't give in.
You can find the quote from the league owner guy. He says, oh, well, you know, this one design we have is urinals for men and women. We're trying to figure out how this is going to work.
It won't
it's
work.
Like, don't mess. They want a social engineer. And they want to bring Muslims in so that they can blow stuff up and shoot us, and they can blame us and take our guns. You're absolutely right, Tim Kennedy. And we need to talk about ways to respond to that. But speaking of the Second Amendment, do you guys have the Rahm Emanuel clip? Because, again, he said during the campaign 8 years ago, we're going to come after you and put you on a no-fly list if you think you're maybe a terrorist. Now, these people protecting the terrorist, but they say they're going to put us on a list. This is the end of the Second Amendment. We know we'll end up getting put on these lists.
Yeah, I will. You will. Because we speak for freedom. And words like freedom, liberty, the Constitution, those will be hot words. Those will be words that if you use them, if you tweet them, if you text them, you will be put on those lists because of it. And then you're on that list. You can't have a gun. Now we have complete barrel-chested freedom fighters, loving barbecue and bourbon, motorcycles, Texas guys that are now just on no-fly lists because we like freedom.
Sure, and that's their answer to the jihadis that have attacked us, who they won't say are jihadis, who they ordered the FBI not to go after. Talking to your sources, and do you guys have the clip? Okay, great. And we'll play it in a moment. I couldn't hear you. Talking to your sources, it's in the news the FBI was ordered to stand down twice on this guy. They've been ordered to stand down on this mosque. Have you talked to anybody? Have you confirmed that?
Yeah, it seems very evident now that not Omar specifically, that there was a stand down from him. I think the FBI in 2013 and 2014 actually did do their due diligence in the investigation. They went and interviewed him twice. It was somewhat inconclusive. And the person that made the reports at his work about him had then left. So that was kind of a moot investigation. So then the second one was when he had a friend that went to Syria and blew himself up. And the fact that he's now been investigated by the FBI twice on for two different things, now three interviews.
Yeah, that's a red flag when your buddy goes and blows themselves up and you go to a mosque saying murder all the infidels.
But it was the mosque that it sounds like there's a stand down for. It wasn't Omar. It was the mosque. Say, no, don't investigate that because, you know, the freedom of religion, we can't do it.
What I love is how Obama gets up on TV today and says, don't use the term radical Islam. And then the media follows his orders and uses what words he says. And his wife tells us what school lunches to eat. Since when did I wake up into a cult?
I had somebody today say, because I'm like, stop calling it a hate crime and a shooter. Call it a terrorist event. And the man was a terrorist or a radical Islamist. But I was getting to, like, it was a hate crime. Yeah, it's a hate crime. They hate all of us. They hate America.
Yeah, they want to just turn it into, oh, it's just hate against the poor gays. No, this is a group coming that says they're going to kill you. Imagine if there was a Christian church in town saying, go out and kill black people or go out and kill gays or whatever. They'd be arrested. Because they're organizing crime. They're organizing racketeering. They're organizing violent events. It's not free speech when you say, go kill people.
I would also be at their doorstep and say, hey, that's not how this works. Because we, as a Christian, we kind of take care of our own. You know, like it's not like a Timothy McVeigh can walk in and be like, hey, I'm going to go blow up a building in Oklahoma. And we're like, oh, that's a good plan. Because we're moderate Christians and we'll allow those things. Or, hey, I'm going to go kill a bunch of gay people. Or I'm going to go kill this woman that had adultery. We're going to stone her to death. And all the other Christians in church are like, yeah, that's good.
Yeah, let's get together and go kill her.
Yeah, they go, we'll do it together. That's not how it works. Instead, we say, no, that's wrong. Don't do that. That's not how it's supposed to go. And then we don't let them do that.
Well, here's Rahm Emanuel, so that you know that when you, this is 8 years ago, when you see them pushing this all over the news, this is their goal. Get rid of legislative process, judicial process, get rid of checks and balances, and just you're on a magic no gun list. Here it is.
They're making sure that we have a president, I cannot put my partisanship aside, a Democratic president who will take that office and use it to protect the streets and the kids that grow up on those streets and make sure that we once again have an assault weapon ban, a Brady bill with the full force of the law on the land, because we need somebody in the Oval Office that moves this Congress. We had an election about change. People are clear about the special interests. They are tired of that gridlock that special interests cause in Washington. And I think the most simple thing we can do, and we've got to make this a number one issue as a test vote and then take it into the election, that is, if you are on the no-fly list because you are known as maybe a possible terrorist, you cannot buy a handgun in America.
And meanwhile, they protect these very groups.
Yeah. So there is no due process to be put on the list. And then once you're on the list, there is no action
to get off it.
To get off the list. It's just like, ah.
There are members of Congress on it. Look, it's clear what's going on. I want to shift gears now in the time we have left. I'm going to skip this network break so we have more time to cover it, to really just tell the viewers and the listeners why they've been seeing more of Tim Kennedy here. Tim, obviously, is one of the hosts of a hit show, Hunting Hitler. I'll talk some about that. Also, you've been fighting a lot in the UFC at the highest levels. And, of course, I've heard there's a big fight coming up. I'm just going to stop right there. Also, you're really good buddies with one of my best friends from high school, Shane Steiner, who folks already know here. And so this really happened by accident because you really don't do a lot of sponsorship stuff. Shane gave you some of the products. And, well, I mean, I guess tell the story yourself, but you sent it off to the anti-doping agency because you really don't take any supplements. Some of them can actually, give you bad tests. You're known as being Mr. Clean. Just a few months ago, they took a whole bunch of tests. Relay all that to folks because you wouldn't be here. You're becoming somebody that's going to promote the products and, kind of have that finance us doing all these video shoots and trips and, reportage if you didn't believe in the products. So tell folks about your experience with some of the products.
Yeah. I train 2-3 times a day. I'm on the range. It's nonstop work from sunrise to sunset, and then hours after that, I'm still working. I'm always looking for the healthy, natural edge, both to push myself as an individual physically, and then as an athlete and as an operator. I think it's our responsibility. I believe in individual responsibility. I believe in freedom. I believe in being a true patriot. And to be a true patriot, you have to be strong. You have to be mentally strong. You have to be physically strong. You have to be capable. You have to be able to work with your hands. You got to be able to pick stuff up. You got to change a transmission. You have to be able to do things. Chop a tree down. Clean your gun. Just like basic things that give you freedoms. If you can't do those things, you're not free. You have to make somebody
else. You got to be able to kill 10 jihadis with a hatchet in close quarters combat.
Effortlessly. That would make me pretty happy. So looking for the edge, looking for whatever, a supplement, a natural ingredient, a food source, micro meals, whatever it is. My friend Shane gave me some of our products.
So Supermail Vitality, X2, and a few of the others.
So I took Supermail, and I can't ingest anything unless I get it approved by the U.S. ADA, the Anti-Doping Administration. So I took it, and I sent it to them. I said, am I allowed to take this? 100%, they said, you're fine. There's nothing in here that is on our ban list. So go ahead and take it. So I started taking it, and I immediately saw a difference. For a guy like me that's a 215, 220-pound athlete, that's 5, 6% body fat, you notice small changes, and that's what you need. You just need little bits, little changes. It's not like I'm going to overnight feel a change. If you have more body fat, if you don't get to train often, you're going to see bigger changes. But for me, I was able to see small changes. So I had the Anti-Doping Administration say I was good to go. Then I started using it and felt good. My wife likes it. My training partner doesn't like it because now I'm being able to hang with him in some of the lifts, and he used to be stronger than me, but I'm coming for you, Shane. It's an amazing product.
I remember Shane one time was bench pressing 400 pounds free bar, some ridiculous, like 30 times in front of me.
He's a monster. He's a monster. Another one of the tenets of kind of like the true patriot idea is having this community. Like you are, yes, we have to be individually strong, but you need people around you that have the liked feelings, shared goals.
How good is he going to get over the years? Because you're a multi-black belt. He's only been doing this like 3 years. I mean, but I'm told he's getting better and better.
God, I'm just glad he's kind of older than me. Because, if he was a few years younger than me, I wouldn't stand a chance.
Yeah, you're just a few years younger than us. He's 42. I'm 42. He's about 43 now. How old are you?
I am 36.
Yeah, so you're still a baby over there.
And I need it. I need it.
But no, that's him. The Steiner genetics. His dad's world bull riding champion.
His dad pisses me off. He's a 65-year-old guy with like an 8-pack.
Oh yeah, and then Sid, of course, is world champion stair roper.
Yeah, they're every one of those guys athletes. They got genetics of greatness, and Shane is no different. It's infuriating when he beats me, and he beats me all the time. Not a grappling or like kickboxing, MMA specific, but like the strength and conditioning stuff. That man is a monster.
But I remember like 2-3 years ago at first, though, you were really pushing him though. I remember he was just like, my God, I can hardly walk after these workouts.
He uses all the products too.
I'm told by folks here in town, though, that you guys do the biggest workouts times two of anybody else.
We had professional athletes with us last week. Professional athletes that try to do our regular Friday workout. They did a third less than us. So they reduced the volume of our work by 33% because they couldn't finish it in time. And they were also throwing up. This is normal when people come and are like, we'll just go get work out with Tim Kennedy. And the funny part is people are always like, Tim uses steroids. Look, you can't have a body like that. You can't look like that. You can't train like that without steroids. Yes, you can. It's called hard work.
Well, also, you got those super Irish genetics.
I mean, I got good genetics. I also have good supplements, thanks to some of these products. You know, I have.
But why is it so many of the top fighters that are white are Irish?
We're just too dumb to quit. We're too tough. I think it's in our genetics. You know, like, hey, starve us. We'll eat corned beef and potatoes. You know, then we'll be immigrants coming to New York and Boston. And, you know, we'll essentially be slaves for like two generations and be fighting with our bare knuckles just for our mere existence. And then it kind of grows on you. You get thick skin.
That which doesn't kill you only makes you stronger.
Right.
Well, I mean, let's be honest about this thing. We were going to do a shooting show 4 years ago. We'd just come out with Super Male Vitality. I'd only started trying to work out again. So Shane's looking at me, you know, this blubber butt. And I'm like, hey, this is from the top guys, concentrated, you know, herbs that are known to get your body to release naturally from your glands. It doesn't mimic testosterone. It just gets your own body to release your own natural stuff. And with all these chemicals in the environment, that suppresses the estrogen mimickers. He goes, listen, he's just, you know, working out 3 hours a day at the time. He goes, listen, none of these supplements work. I just need plenty of protein, plenty of sleep. And he goes, really, you're selling supplements? And I said, okay, take some home. About a week later, he goes, I want to buy a whole box. He goes, all I know is it makes my wife go crazy and me go crazy. It's the libido. And he goes, workout-wise, it makes me want to work out longer and I just have a better attitude. What is in this? And he starts going, is this legal? And I'm going, dude, we just have a top herbologist. This stuff's made in Utah by like this 100-year-old company. I'm not going to say who. They private label it, but it's our proprietary. That's why we run out so much, though, because it's like condensed. It's never heat-pressed. So it's still alive. And the biggest thing I noticed within 24 hours is the libido. Not that I had any problems. And, of course, but then Shane really got into it. His dad got into it. And it even helped him actually go from being bulky to slimming down. So it really is real. It really does have an effect. And I'll tell you, I got more energy, started making my hair fall out a little bit faster. I mean, it's real, folks. So consult your physician before you take it. But it's all seen as FDA grass certified. That's a congressional law term, meaning everything in it is certified and seen by the government as safe. We don't put anything in there that's even halfway on a list, okay, which you can do all day long. This is truly natural, and it helps fund the broadcast and so much what we're doing. But I'm just, you know, glad to have you involved. So, you know, as you know, go take the title and everything and UFC and everything, that I definitely will have you there promoting the product. But it's real. It has an effect. Talk about the effects that it had for you.
Recovery was the thing that I noticed first and foremost. So you work hard. You have a 90-minute workout. You have 4, 5, 6 hours until the next workout. During those 4, 5, 6 hours, you are doing everything that you can to get your body healthy again so you can go train and push yourself to the limit. So in those 4, 5, 6 hours, you know, you're ice bathing, cryotherapy, you're taking supplements, micronutrients, you know, coffee, nootropics, all these things, just trying to speed up the recovery process, you know, get the lactic acid out of your muscles, get good positive white blood cells back into the muscles for repair. And so what I noticed first and foremost was how quickly I was recovering. I would get done with a workout within an hour or two. I was like chomping at the bit to go train again, to get back on the range to shoot, to hop on the next helicopter, to go down the next rappel wall, to go skydiving, to go whatever my day had in it. And I have some crazy, crazy stuff in my day. I wanted to go right to it. That's what I felt. I was like, let's go. What's next?
What about the libido? You can't say what you said earlier in the office, but that's the easiest to notice.
Yeah, that is absolutely noticeable. You know, I got an amazing wife. I got a beautiful wife. You know, like, it's not part of my culture or religion to beat her. You know, she can wear a bikini when she wants. She can have bourbon when she wants. She can have a beer when she wants. She can do whatever she wants. She's also a beautiful woman. So, that supplement's pretty fantastic.
Well, the thing is, Super Female works on males or females. I mean, the formulas are almost the same, but it's got a few things in it for women that are in the women's. But I'm just being honest. This is not sold as that, but this is really what everybody can guarantee it does.
Yeah.
It certainly works. How much do you take, though? I think Shane overdoses a bit.
He does. So I take 3 droplets twice a day. Which is the recommendation right on the, you know, the label.
Yeah, 3 dropperfuls.
Yep, 3 dropperfuls twice a day.
Yeah.
And, you know, for my
life, I can't even do that much.
Well, you know, like,
because I'll be honest, I get a little too aggressive.
I'm on a range 4 or 5 hours on a helicopter.
I guess you're using it all up.
I eat 6,000 calories in a day. 6,000 calories. Like that's twice of what most people eat.
By the way, the sad part about you awesome special forces guys is you'll, especially in the Army, you'll never talk about the stuff you've done, but talking to other people in the Army and also looking into it, you're like one of the best snipers, they say, in modern times. So all the stuff's classified. You were actually on the same ground as Chris Kyle a lot in Iraq. And when it comes down, you've written the Army's close combat manual. You've rewritten it. This guy wrote the manual on close combat. Now that's, I mean, I'm like, you're the, aren't you like the Army soldier?
I guess so. You know, all of the metrics that you do to measure kind of like one's lethality, both shooting, long distance, mid distance. I'm the champion of pretty much all of them. Yeah. So.
And now he's in the info war and supporting what we're doing. It's exciting. Tim Kennedy, five more minutes with him, and then he's running. And then we've got other guests coming in. Stay with us. We'll be right back in 70 seconds. All right, we got 5 minutes left with Tim Kennedy. He is a busy guy. He got home at like 2 a.m. last night from doing, Tooth Fairy work. And then he's here. He's got a big movie premiering tomorrow. And he's going out on the street with us tomorrow to do some clandestine stuff. So run through it. But you wanted us to play this clip. They're having to find it. So I'll play it later and put it together with you talking about it on the nightly news. But describe this clip.
It's the embodiment, it's the personification of the neutering of what it means to be a man. So this guy goes and shoots an M4 at the range, and he has this catastrophic, nearly traumatic event while he's trying to shoot an M4. It's 223. This is what I let like my 10-year-old shoot. It's just a little bit bigger than a 22.
There's no kick.
No kick at all.
Not if you push it in your shoulder.
Nothing. So he shoots this gun a couple of times, and he's like, the concussion, the gases, the smell of it all. It was so overwhelming. I had post-traumatic stress for hours after it.
He's trying to create a phobia. Exactly. So people don't do it. I mean, I'm not the super soldier, but I sit there and fire 100 rounds with a 50 cal handheld.
Effortlessly.
And then these guys are like, can't shoot a 223.
I don't know if they've been like actually emasculated or if they're just trying to demonstrate to the world how weak Americans are. I mean, it seems like it's intentional. He's like, no. It's not cool to go and work hard and to go train and go shoot. It's better just to be like the biggest sissy on the planet that can't even shoot a 223 because it hurts my shoulder. And the gases and seeing the brass fly out, it's traumatizing. I can't take it.
Well, that's like the social justice warriors that see the chalk on the ground and start freaking out and convulsing. All right, so seriously, a lot of you haven't tried Super Male Vitality. Some of the other products that Tim likes are all listed. They're all 15% off today. I should have added that for folks to take advantage of this. And obviously, you know, Tim wouldn't endorse something if he didn't really like it. He's a top athlete. You don't see him out there endorsing other stuff. If you try it, folks, it'll blow you away. Bottom line, it supports the broadcast. But beyond that, you know, as Tim, you know, reaches out as an ambassador of liberty out there to the sporting community and has all sorts of big deals with CBS broadcasting sports and UFC and so many and hunting Hitler and all this other incredible stuff, he's an ambassador for liberty and really an ambassador for all the patriots that are in the military that think just like he does.
Yeah,
is that fair to say?
Absolutely. Everyone's like, why? Why do you do this? Why do you not sleep? Why do you not ever take a day off? Why? Why are you like?
Because you're alive.
One, because I'm alive. The layers of blindness have been pulled, and that's because of hard work. And I want the biggest platform I can. I want to be on CBS. I want to be on the History Channel. Not for me. I don't care about, like, my family's going to be taken care of forever. I want to preach. I want everybody to know how important truth and liberty is. And wherever
we've already dominated on every other front. Now you're going to do it in the info war.
Yeah. So wherever I
welcome
can
to the info war.
I love it. Fights come to them.
But it's perfect. You live here in Austin. You've been friends with Shane so long, and this happened totally organically.
Yep. We got more coming. You know, we're gonna give you the stuff you need to know how to be a patriot. We're gonna go film stuff this weekend. We're gonna go shoot film stuff next week. It is gonna be what the steps you need to take about how to be free, how to get free like food, not from the government, how to grow it, how to change your oil. How to clean your gun, how to go to the range, what drills you should do at the shooting range.
And you're about to go shoot another season of Hunting Hitler. And of course, you discovered that big house and all that,
yeah,
owned by German contractors, owned by German corporations. You are finding where the Nazis ran.
So last season, we kind of had some gloves off or gloves on. We're taking the gloves off this year. We did the research last year. Now we are executing. We're going to show you kind of what happened, what you can do with money, and when you have media support behind you. And these were socialists, fascist socialists, that went on the run and then hid in South America.
All right. And where's your movie premiere tomorrow night?
Movie premieres worldwide. Range 15, range15.com to get tickets. And it's veteran everything. It is veteran made.
You're a wild man, Tim Kennedy. Amazing. And of course, sheepdogresponse.com.
I'm as crazy and good.
All right. Good job, buddy. Good to have you here.
Thank you.
Orlando over the weekend, a radical Islamic terrorist killed 49 people at least and wounded dozens more. Dozens. It was the worst terrorist attack since September 11th and the worst mass shooting in our country's history. We want to live in a country where gay and lesbian Americans and all Americans are safe from radical Islam. Which, by the way, wants to murder and has murdered gays, and they enslave women. Now, Hillary Clinton talks about women, and she talks about how she's going to do it. She plays the woman card more than any human being I've ever seen in my life. And frankly, I don't even think women like her from everything I see. And yet she's taken $25 million from certain countries, and much more than that when you add it up, that treat women horrendously, that kill gays. And you know what's going to happen, folks? And you know what we're going to do right now? Let's call for Hillary and Bill Clinton to give back the $25+ million to the countries that we're talking about. Once again, we've seen that political correctness is deadly. They don't want to talk about the problem. And I watched President Obama today, and he was more angry at me than he was at the shooter. And many people said that. One of the folks on television said, boy, has Trump gotten under his skin. But he was more angry, and a lot of people have said this, the level of anger, that's the kind of anger he should have for the shooter and these killers that shouldn't be here.
That's right. The globalists are engaged in a conquering of the United States, a cultural conquering, using Islam that they're bringing in. They allow the radical elements to organize, attack, and then they say, oh, we're going to censor your Facebook or Twitter if you criticize it. You're stirring them up. We're going to take you off this local radio station because you're Islamophobic. Look at this headline out of Reuters. Islamophobia on the rise in Germany, study finds. Because of the rapes, the robberies, the murders? Is it phobia of, say, black widows? They can kill you? A phobia is something that's illegitimate. You know, it's a fear that's irrational. You talk to the hundreds of thousands of Christians killed by ISIS in Syria and other areas and ask me if their fear of Islam is a phobia. This is mental illness. And we see the left, who has to just say everything but the West is a good thing. Everything that is the West is bad. And we have Milo Yiannopoulos, one of the biggest Twitter followings on the internet, Breitbart editor of technology, that we're going to have a reporter there tonight covering this. In Florida, it's just been banned by the police. They say, well, you know, and the stuff he says is milquetoast, but it's just free speech. Oh, you might make the Muslims mad. They might come shoot you. It's banned. And then Twitter took his account away and disappeared him. He's been suspended from Twitter. Okay? And if you try to criticize Obamacare being a ripoff, you get kicked off Twitter. You get kicked off Facebook. I mean, this is totalitarianism. This is sickening. And we see this administration going after whistleblowers. I have high-level counterterrorism sources who say, look, we're not even allowed to go to these mosques, the mosque where the imam in Florida, this guy went to saying kill homosexuals. We're not even allowed to investigate his dad, any of it, in order to stand down. I asked Tim Kennedy about it. He said, absolutely, that's what's going on. And he's in the most elite units there are for counterterrorism. Obviously, he can't tell me specifics. But that's what's happening. And then we are joined by the author of See Something, Say Nothing. This has been highly recommended by folks in special forces that are involved in domestic operations. This has been highly recommended by Roger Stone. He was on yesterday. This has been highly recommended by everybody from WorldNet Daily Books. We're not selling it yet. We should. I saw a lot of WorldNet Daily Books. Philip Haney and Art Moore, See Something, Say Nothing. A Homeland Security officer exposes the government's submission to jihad. There is a stand down going on. And when Obama opens the door, brings people in, blocks the FBI and others from stopping it, well, that's a false flag. They're going to blame the Second Amendment. It's real terror. It's real jihad. It's real Islamic behavior. Orthodox Islamic behavior. That's what they call radical Islam. But when the government or criminal elements of it open the door and protect it and call off the sheepdogs and let them attack, it's a false flag. And now Obama came out and blamed the Second Amendment and said American terrorist, homegrown. We need more laws, even though this guy was working for a security contractor out of the UK. Even though he told coworkers, I'm going to kill people, they wouldn't do anything. His boss wouldn't do anything because they're protecting it. It's beyond political correctness, and they're holding America hostage now with these jihad forces, saying, you submit to us, just like they declared civil emergency in Europe, in France and Germany, arresting people that hand out flyers on the street, suspending people's Facebook accounts. We videotaped it last week, our reporters in Dresden. We see General Petraeus walking by and asking him about it. He runs from us to go into the Bilderberg meeting. That's how he's getting millions from the Saudis. Hillary's gotten 20% of her money from the Saudis. So he joins us for the rest of the hour. Philip Haney studied Arabic culture and language while working as a scientist in the Middle East before he was hired as a founding member of the Department of Homeland Security in 2003, becoming an Armed Customs and Border Patrol Protection Officer. He served several tours of duty in the National Targeting Center near Washington, D.C., where he quickly was promoted to its advanced targeting team, an unprecedented accomplishment for an agent on temporary duty assignment. Officer Haney won numerous awards and commendations for his superiors for meticulously compiling information and producing actionable reports that led to the identification of hundreds of terrorists. He has specifically specialized in Islamic theology and the strategy and tactics of the global Islamic movement. He retired honorably in July 2015 and has now written the book, See Something, Say Nothing. We saw an article about this Sunday. It was bombshell. We wrote about it. Drudge picked it up. Here's the headline. Hillary State Department blocked investigation into Orlando killer's mosque. Further proof Hillary funded rise of ISIS. Well, that's what Seymour Hersh has talked about. So this is deeper than just political correctness. I wanted to get into the meat and potatoes of this, and I appreciate him coming on with us. You can find the book at WorldNet Daily, Amazon.com, everywhere else. But I want to ask Philip Haney about persecution of whistleblowers, about what's really going on inside, and my statement of this has got to go beyond political correctness. Even though Saudi Arabia is teetering on the edge of collapse in many respects, from my research, correct me if I'm wrong, still it's like they're failing forward, like dominating the West, buying everybody off, and pretty much holding us hostage that if we don't submit to them, they'll activate these terror cells. Mr. Haney, is that an accurate statement, or correct me if I'm wrong? Of where I'm wrong.
Well, in particular, the organizations that are what I call the Asian branch of the global Islamic movement are funded by Saudi Arabia through the madrasa system. So, yes, there is a direct link, a historical link between Saudi Arabia and the funding of the madrasas, the Islamic schools that these individuals go to from the time they're little kids till they're grown up. That produces Taliban and a group called Tablighi-Jamaat, Lashkar-e-Taiba. Those are the groups that come from Bangladesh, India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, that part of the world. So, yes, there is a connection.
Well, let's talk about your book, just in a gestalt. What's really happening? Why we see, whether it's San Bernardino or whether it's Orlando or Fort Hood, they say it's not Islamic terror. They try to cover it up. But before it happens, we see that there's agents being told, we may investigate you for civil rights investigations. Stop looking into this. And we got this guy's dad at the White House. What's going on here?
Well, the father was the vice president of the mosque, the Fort Pierce Mosque. If you took him at face value when he started appearing in public, you got the impression he had no clue whatsoever what his son was doing. But he's actually the vice president of the mosque. And there's a concept that I'd like to try to share with everyone, and that is like the solar system. all the planets in the solar system rotate around the sun. Yes, there are different kinds of planets, and they have moons and so on. But the one thing that they all have in common is the force of gravity that comes from the sun influences all of them. And the thing that is driving the whole global jihad movement, global Islamic movement, is the one thing, is the implementation of Sharia law. That is the macro strategic goal of the global Islamic movement. It isn't actually jihad or terrorism or any of the rest of the things that we're calling it. It is Sharia law. And the other things, terrorism and so on, are tactics to implement the strategic goal of Sharia law. It's actually quite simple when you put it that way.
Am I right in saying that I think they've launched a new phase of a hot war, testing and probing with these basic sleeper cells and other organizations that are just directed by ideology?
Well, they are bound by their ideologies. I should say compelled. Like water, when it meets an obstacle, water will either go over, around, through, or under any obstacle that it meets. That's the implacable force of water. And the gravitational force of Sharia law is exerts itself in exactly the same way. So they are compelled to find different tactical approaches to achieving their overriding strategic goal, which is implementation of Sharia law.
Wow. Well, I want to go through all this, the Orlando attacks and more, but first, obviously, the stand downs, the agents like yourself not allowed to do their job, the FBI ordered to stand down. I mean, it's every time from Hassan to San Bernardino to this to the Army-Navy recruiting centers where they say it wasn't an attack. I mean, what? I mean, we know what the jihadis are up to, but what's happening at the White House? We'll be back. Security Dome. Well, now the book's called See Something, Say Nothing. Retired DHS intelligence officer blows the whistle on federal government's role in Islamic terror threat. Let's get into that right now about the book and then how that parlays over into what's currently happening. I mean, it's incredible. All the public threats these people make, the traveling overseas, their buddies are blowing themselves up. He's telling coworkers he's going to kill them. His brother-in-law is bringing in refugees. The dad's hanging out with Obama. What in Hades is going on? What is Obama thinking?
Well, I wish I had about a minute with him. I don't know who's advising, but I can guarantee you one thing. If I had an opportunity to sit him down with a magic law enforcement computer, I could show him within 1 minute, 2 minutes top, all the derogatory information on every one of these individual organizations, particularly the Muslim Brotherhood front groups in the United States and the mosques, the affiliated organizations and mosques. I could show him. We have archives of derogatory information on these organizations going back years and years. Myself and my colleagues have put it in. We've done our job, but the administration literally, deliberately and intentionally has refused to acknowledge the existence of this information.
So to be clear, there's files on all these people. They're saying we need more NSA stuff, but it's all there, and they're just not acting on it.
The Department of Homeland Security, Customs and Border Protection was founded to gather first-level intelligence information at the border, meaning when you encounter people coming back from flights from overseas or when they're preparing to depart, to go outbound, we call it, to go overseas. We have the authority within the border, a greater amount of authority than the CIA and the FBI combined, to gather this kind of basic intelligence information. And over the years, we have been handcuffed more and more to the point where we're barely capable of gathering the kind of information that we could then share, let's say, with the FBI. And collaborate with them, conduct effective law enforcement operations. But over time, as it's described in the book, this was diminished more and more each year.
Why do you think they're phasing in this stand down? Because the Border Patrol admits that they're ordered to, quote, complete the smuggling process just of illegals in general or the so-called minor children. And then we also see the reports in the news where planes land from all over the world, and they're said, oh, we're not going to check their IDs or anything right now. Just bring them on in. I mean, what's going on there?
That's an abrogation of the basic responsibility of any elected official, is to uphold the constitutional command or mandate to protect American citizens from threat, both foreign and domestic. We're talking here about a macro level abrogation of responsibility that's putting us all at threat. And as long as we stand by and allow the administration to continue to misinform us and disinform us, then we're going to see the same results that we've seen so far over and over again, because the global Islamic movement is not going to tell us thank you for allowing us to make this much progress. Now we'll stop. Every step forward they take, they reinforce their position and look for a tactical opportunity to make another move forward. We see it everywhere in the world, and North America is not immune from this force of gravity.
Well, that's what you wrote in the book, and then the book just came out, and boom, look what just happened. Do you see this just in patterns, that the jihad attacks are obviously increasing? Will they increase exponentially, or do they go in waves, or what does your gut tell you? What do your colleagues tell you?
I can tell you, based on numbers, there have been more than 28,000 Islamic jihad attacks in the world since 9/11. That averages out to about one an hour. So they're happening like lightning strikes all over the world continuously. Again, America is not immune. Until the day comes that we are able to honestly and courageously stand up and have a discussion about the nature of Sharia law and how it is compatible with the U.S. Constitution, then we're not going to have the wherewithal we need to recover ourselves and really stand up for the principles that this country was founded on. This isn't really even a civil rights issue at all. This is a basic survival issue.
Well, I know this. We've done this on air. When there's mosques openly calling for killing people, we'll call Homeland Security, and they don't even care. Or we'll point out things are going on, and it just seems to go into a black hole. But then, meanwhile, Obama's on TV saying the number one threat is Christians and gun owners, and that American homegrown terrorism is the problem. This guy wasn't homegrown. His parents were from Afghanistan. His dad was the vice president of the mosque, as you were speaking of earlier, and others were. It's just amazing. We'll be back with the author of See Something, Say Nothing, a whistleblower on what's happening inside DHS. Straight ahead, I'm Alex Jones. You know, I've been friends with Shane Steiner since high school, really good friends with him, and his family just has total Texas integrity. Salt of the earth, folks. You can trust him with my life. And Shane's been friends with Tim Kennedy for about 3 years. And we're about to go back to our guest. And he said he's one of the best guys he's ever known. And, you know, they work out like 5 days a week. And, of course, Tim Kennedy is currently, it's no secret, but he don't want me to get into it, so I won't, in Special Forces. The military rates him in the Army, but also in Joint Forces Command, as all around the top soldier in the U.S. military. Now, I brought that up, and he said, okay, yeah, it's true. But he is the top soldier in the U.S. military. The top of the Special Forces, the top of Delta Force, the top of the SEALs, the top of all of them. And the point is that it's not even known, popularly known. It's like, oh, former Special Forces soldier. And it's just fate that Shane, 3 years ago, through his other UFC buddies, got to know Tim, and Tim was fighting for the middle heavyweight championship, had beaten the guy. He wouldn't come out of the corner. It's a famous fight, and the guy came out and, you know, got him at the end or whatever, but the point is, obviously, he's going to be going for the title in the future. I'm just going to leave it at that. It's going to be a big deal when it's announced, and it's going to be in the biggest venue ever, and I'm going to just stop talking. The point is that it's great for the info war to have him involved with us. I'm very excited. I didn't even really try to do this whole sponsorship deal. He wasn't even really, he's so busy. He tried the products, and this was like 6 months ago or 8 months ago. And then it took months for the anti-doping, you know, group to then approve for him to use it. He just tried them and said, wow, this works. Went off of them, got them to, you know, check it, and then said, well, great, I'm allowed to use this. Of course it passes the anti-doping deal. I mean, you know, we know we're under total FDA microscopes here. Plus, I'm not going to sell stuff that mimics testosterone in the body. What Dr. Group says it does, and that's why all the big nutraceutical experts love our stuff at InfoWarsLife.com, is it gets your body to just operate at a higher level. And whether it's stamina, libido, you name it, I'm still not Mr. Beach Boy, but I've lost, I mean, I was like 280 pounds. A lot of it was fat. I've lost over 50 pounds in fat. I mean, I'll put it that way. 60 or 70 pounds it's got to be, because I've gained a lot of muscle. And this is a big part of it. We have the Tim Kennedy special running, 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12. That's the three products he wants to endorse that he really has felt a big difference with. As part of our partnership with Special Forces Operator and UFC fighter Tim Kennedy, we're giving you 15% off the top InfoWars Life formula used by Tim Kennedy. 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com right now for a limited time. And he takes the Brain Force on missions, likes it better than coffee or other stimulants that the Army pushes. I'll just leave it at that. These are the products that Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training that help him go to the next level. All three products have hundreds of five-star reviews and contain the known herbs that help boost your body naturally. Now is the time to stock up and get your products 50% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Visit InfoWarsLife.com and get on the Tim Kennedy InfoWars Life routine with Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, Secret 12, and InfoWarsLife.com. And I'll close by saying this. This whole sponsorship thing is only 30% maybe of what we're overall doing. Having him sponsored now means he can do all these gun shows, training shows, blacksmithing, urban survival, urban farming, combat, intelligence operations, HUMET, training you to be HUMET in the street. This is exactly what we need. And so this can have, the guy wants to work like 6 days a week when he's here. He's about to go to Argentina for hunting Hitler. He's got a bunch of other special operation stuff he does. And he can get called away at any time when there's terror attacks, obviously. But the point is we're going to have a lot of content from Tim Kennedy for the nightly news, for just free online for everybody, for the radio show. It's exciting. And then around that, I intend to try to build a whole division that's about empowering the individual. That doesn't mean I'm up here on some high horse and perfect. I used to run 6 miles a day every other day, you know, lift weights crazy. Hell, with Shane 20 years ago. And then I just got, I don't want to say depressed, but just started fighting the New World Order, stopped caring about myself, and just started working all the time and just totally got so unego-driven, I didn't care how I looked. Until I realized about 5-6 years ago, I said, you know, I'm going to turn this around. It's been a long fight, but I've turned it a lot around. And so it's, you know, exciting what's happened, and it's very exciting to have Tim Kennedy involved with us. And that was natural because Shane's been involved for 4 years with us, 5 years with the shooting. So that all happened naturally. It fits in with Joe Biggs and what he's doing. And now we're reaching out to the Special Forces community, the military community, period, because they're the group that's the biggest group of info warriors, folks that are awake. Now, going back to our guest who want to invite back up in the near future for a nightly news interview, and of course he is Philip Haney, See Something, Say Nothing, retired DHS intelligence officer, blows whistle on federal government's role in Islamic terror threat. We got like 5 minutes left. I really appreciate your time, sir. You're basically on the national news right now. We have audience much bigger than CNN, say, with their average show, millions an hour. Just what's the data dump folks need to know about the stand down in government and where this is going?
Well, counterterrorism is just like my former career as a scientist in entomology. It's very simple. Follow the trail, find the nest. That's counterterrorism in a nutshell. Follow the trail, find the nest. We're being told by the administration there is no nest. Don't even look for it because it doesn't exist. And that's about as absurd as it would be to go around stomping on ants one at a time while pretending there is no nest. So I would encourage us to reevaluate the way we approach this problem and recognize that it's not just individuals, it's also networks. And that those networks exist here in the United States. They've been built up over at least three generations of immigrants primarily, and that we're not immune to the forces of the Sharia law and influence of Islamic life. So we have to come to terms with this and then compare it to the Constitution and stand up for it courageously when they are not compatible. That's what I would say. Follow the trail, find the nest, and let us do our jobs in the law enforcement community and in the military community. We've been handcuffed by rules of engagement to the point that we're virtually, it's almost impossible for us to do our job.
Why do you think that's being done? I mean, for me, it's beyond political correctness. Why would Europe let 5 million of these people in the last 3 years? I mean, this is suicidal.
Yes, it's a kind of a psychosis. There, Natan Sharansky has a premise that's very true. If you lose your identity as a person or a nation, you will die. You cannot continue to function if you lose your identity. And that's what we're on the verge of doing if we're not careful.
We don't have an identity except political correctness. It's just a bunch of mindless fluff.
Well, I'd like to recommend listeners to go to the 2012 FBI Touchstone document, their training guidelines, where in paragraph one, it says that even though an individual is affiliated with a known terrorist organization, you're basically not allowed to assume that that person himself might be a terrorist.
That's funny. Sorry.
That's why the FBI seems to be having trouble connecting the dots with these kind of investigations.
Yeah, I talked to some folks that were there on the ground in Orlando, and they call them all in the briefing rooms, military, FBI, you name it, and they tell them, you are not investigating Islamists. You are not investigating the mosque. You are not to use the word Muslim. This is not an investigation of Muslims. And there's like 100 people in a room with Homeland Security from Jay Johnson up there, one of his lackeys, telling him this. This is ridiculous.
And see, that's what I mean about an abrogation of the Constitution. Our founding fathers, the geniuses that they were, set up a checks and balance system. Do you realize how much of it, how far from due process we are when we have one branch, the executive branch of the government, dictating what every other branch shall do, including law enforcement, and intruding themselves into the law enforcement arena with policies that are subjective, that have no oversight?
It's totally dictatorial. I mean, you can get away with anything. That's how Hillary can do all this illegal stuff, is because the executive's covering her butt.
Well, I was investigated 9 times by my own agency for doing my job. I took the oath to defend our country from threat, both foreign and domestic. I took it very seriously, and it got me in a lot of trouble. But thank God I was able to survive it and retire honorably. And that's why I'm telling my story now, because my vow is still on active duty.
That's right. Let me ask you this question. The people persecuting you, were they doing it just to climb the ladder? Or was it this sick leftist love affair with anything anti-freedom? I mean, for me, it's a form of Stockholm syndrome meets bondage. I mean, it's kind of like 50 Shades of Grey taken to the next level. There's this weird infatuation, I know, with liberal women to go have, jihadi husbands and be slapped around. I mean, I don't understand it.
There's two factors. It's ideological for sure, but there's another one I think is deeper, and that is fear. The fear of doing the right thing. Fear of loss. If you do the right thing, you might suffer loss. And that fear keeps people from doing what they know is right. In other words, it keeps them from fulfilling their vow. Fear is a very powerful and destructive force.
Oh, boy, is it.
And
I can't live under it. My only fear is that I'm going to roll over and be a jellyfish. I only beat myself up, and I'm serious. I wish I could find a way to not feel guilty that I'm not doing enough. I am so unhappy right now. I have never been this unhappy. I should be happy. We're waking a lot of folks up, but I am just seeing the president get up today and blame, quote, Americans. He said Americans. We've got to keep guns out of the hands of Americans like this. This guy wasn't an American.
No, he wasn't. He was a citizen of our country, but he was not an American in the constitutional definition, which leads to another issue that the argument.
That's right. I mean, if he's pledged allegiance to ISIS, he's pledged allegiance to a foreign power. Deport his ass.
That's right. It's assimilation. We hear about it a lot, as though it's Americans' fault that Muslims can't assimilate or won't. It's not our fault. They have to make the choice to assimilate. But they are taught that it is the abrogation, a violation of Sharia law to assimilate to a non-Islamic culture. They're not here to assimilate. They didn't come here to learn to like hot dogs and watermelon. They came here with an understanding that if they come here and settle in a country and implement Islam and Sharia law, that they will receive the same reward in heaven as the men with the guns. And that is an Islamic theological fact. They know it when they come here, that if they promote Islam and the implementation of Sharia law, not the U.S. Constitution, that they will receive a reward in heaven from Allah.
Yeah, the left thinks they're going to assimilate, and they're totally out of their minds.
No, the harder they try to make them, the worse it will get.
Well, I'm not assimilating to the leftist garbage either, and I'm not assimilating to jihad garbage either. I'm not going under any of this, and I'm telling you, it is really getting bad, and I'm seeing it all over Austin, and I'm seeing, you know, the left cuckold to this whole deal, and I'm not going to put up with it. Philip?
One last thing. If we don't face it voluntarily, we will ultimately face it involuntarily. It's inevitable one way or the other. We have to deal with this from a constitutional perspective.
Well, let me ask you this then, because I've got other guests coming in, but I want to invite you back. In 60 seconds, how do we counter this?
Become familiar with the Constitution and become familiar with Sharia law. Arm yourselves with information. Gain a mastery of this subject. You have to be a part of it. And then go back and read the Declaration of Independence. What it called us to do as citizens is to be in control of our own government. We have the right to do it. We need to do it. Now is the time. Not tomorrow. Now.
Philip, we look forward to speaking to you again. Thank you for going through all that persecution to get this book out. I talked to Joseph Ferrer earlier this week. He's very, very proud of this book and that they've published it and the courage you've had. Thank you.
You bet. Thank you, everyone, for listening as well.
You bet. Let's bring in the other guys now that were just over in Europe for 10 days covering Bilderberg, the very globalists that are engineering all this. I mean, these people are just, and again, this whole Islamic invasion, I don't want to obsess on it all day. I have to because they're blaming guns and the Second Amendment and America and Americana. By name, Obama is blaming us. So here's the deal. You're not blaming me and my family, you piece of filth. You're not going to gut what's left of the country and have extrajudicial no gun buy list. I'm not putting up with it. People say, oh, well, what are you going to do? Let me tell you, we're going to do a lot. We mean business. And Obama doesn't look too happy these days because they bit off more than they can chew. Let me tell you something. They're not getting away with this. And we have to understand, no matter what color we are or where we're from or what we stand for, you know, religiously or whatever, we should stand for free speech. And I'm not here to just hate Muslims. They're bullied by their own system as well. But I didn't opt in to be under your system. And my daughters and my son didn't either, okay? So it's not happening. And I'm not going to go along with a police state either that's built up to supposedly counter you, but we never counter what you're doing. So there is a clash of civilizations taking place. We are being played off against each other. I recognize that people in Islamic countries are going to fall victim of this. There is a larger game plan. But if we can't even address Islam and radical forms that are really orthodox, then there's no way to turn this around. And you guys were over there in Europe. You went to the refugee camps. You got run off from them. You did a great job. Petraeus ran away from you. Amazing job, Josh Owens and, of course, Rob Dew, back here in the United States.
Yeah, it was pretty spectacular the way the German people especially, they are divided. And it's a harsh division between anti-migration and people who think it's okay and they can take as many as they want because they kept saying, we're a rich nation, we're a rich nation. And they just don't see where's the money going to come from. You're already taxed, you know.
Well, it's their religion. I mean, they were brainwashed under the Nazis. Mm-hmm. The brainwashing just continued right after that.
Yeah.
The Germans are just totally brainwashed.
Nice people, but they definitely believe that they can handle all this stuff. Now, Czech Republic, where we were, we met a lady at who ran a church there, and she said they've only taken in 500 migrants. 500 migrants in the last, like, 3 years.
Well, that's because they lie on the news. But, yeah, it's lesser numbers there.
Yeah.
Well, look, different leaders in Eastern Europe say this is a globalist invasion. They know what it is.
Right.
They say this is a Bilderberg invasion to break our countries down.
Exactly. And that was one of the big talking points going into Bilderberg was what they're going to do. I think it was how do we keep this migrant invasion going and couch it differently and, you know, to make the people accept that we need more migrants. And I don't think they do. I don't think they need any more migrants. I don't think they're helping. They don't allow them to work. They don't allow them to even come in and be productive citizens. So I don't know why you're bringing them into your country. I don't know what purpose that serves.
so they can blow stuff up and shoot people, and then you can take their liberties away. What do you think's going on, Josh?
Well, we spoke to a guy just outside of Nuremberg on the way to Dresden, and he was upset, basically, that on the streets, people weren't accepting they weren't accepting things that he was doing. So he was like, I'm glad that I get free stuff. I'm glad that I don't have to work. I'm glad that, I get food and I don't have to pay for anything, but I hate this place and I don't want to be here anymore. And I think it was evident that he felt that he was supposed to come over here with open arms, and that he was just supposed to be given everything, also with people on the street giving him a positive attitude also to reinforce his ideals.
Kissing his ass isn't enough.
Yeah, exactly.
He's got a bad attitude. Look, when humans have stuff too good too long, they decide to destroy themselves. That's what this is. This is suicide. By the way, the move to take our guns is so horrible that I've almost gotten conditioned to it. Didn't even cover this. Kit Daniels wrote about it yesterday at Infowars.com. Here it is, Rolling Stone. Why it's time to repeal the Second Amendment. It needs to be replaced because it's outdated, a threat to liberty, and a suicide pact. So we bring in the jihadis, we let them kill us, we blame America, and then take our liberties, just like Europe's done. Truly, truly sickening. Josh Owens to infiltrate the Muslims has grown his big beard, but I'm told that thing is coming off this weekend.
It's coming off this weekend. It has to. It's got to be done.
Red beard. What does your girlfriend think, or fiance?
She's ready for it to come off.
I'm ready for it to come off.
It's coming off.
Let me just say, I love you. You're a great editor, great camera guy, funny guy. I love you to death. That's why I don't know how you can have a beard like that. Are you trying to be Grizzly?
Well, if my parents are watching this, they would love what you just said.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Is everyone like beating you up about it?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when we were in Germany, I just kept getting called Taliban constantly. So
we started calling him Jihadi Josh. That was our nickname for him.
It is a little, oh my God, dude. I'm sorry. Anyways, you've got like your dudester, Deuterino, or the dude for short.
This is probably coming off too. My wife doesn't like it either. Women don't like the beard. So whatever.
It looks good for you.
I look like I'm 15 without it. When I shave off, I'm just so baby.
Piece of work, dude. Hey, let's get serious, though. They don't want to come for our guns. No one wants your guns. They're just all over the news saying ban them.
Right.
But everything's fine. And Obamacare is free, even though new reports out, AP, that Obamacare premiums are exploding again.
Yeah. And here's the thing. There's over 20 million guns, over 200 million rounds of ammunition. It's probably even more than that, that the American people.
Yeah, that's a way to persecute the American people. If they can ban it, they can raise hell against it.
I mean, if it was such a problem, there would be mass shootings every week, but it's not.
Mass shootings are down since 1992.
Exactly.
Overall shootings are down 60-something%. They know that. They just hype the daylights. Listen.
Yeah.
It's like this alligator at Disney World grabbing the kid.
Yeah.
The same alligator, but they think chased a kid last week. They didn't do anything about it.
Right.
Are you going to. Now, listen. Is there a perception now that alligators are everywhere, even though it's super rare? It's like great white sharks, like I always say. But if a great white shark attacks a beach, they close it for a week.
Right.
Even though it might happen once a year on a whole eastern seaboard or western seaboard.
Yeah, exactly. Here's, with that alligator thing, what they've done is protect the alligator so nobody hunts it. They're not allowed to hunt them, only in certain areas. And so they go, they mass populate.
And they've been killing everybody's dogs and cats, and now it's time for your kids.
That's what they do. They're a giant lizard that eats things. I mean, it's terrible what happened to this kid.
And by the way, it's its culture to eat children. So I think you should go and anything and feed your children to the alligators at Disney World.
Well, they find alligators all the time eating dead bodies and stuff in canals, and they're always pulling out half-eaten dead bodies out of canals in Florida. It happens,
and they're always spitting it. Oh, we think the person fell in.
No,
it's not the alligator that did it. Plastic, oh, not me.
And it's weird it happened in what Disney World, like one of these really.
You go to Mexico, they got signs everywhere going, "Do not swim here," and it's just a picture of an alligator or a crocodile.
They had a lady
dumbass tourist get in.
There's a lady who got killed in Australia. They went swimming in a beach where they said don't go swimming. She went swimming with her friend. She gets pulled under and dies.
Yeah, 20-foot saltwater crocky.
Yeah, exactly. That's
like, hello, I'm liberal crocodile. I love you. It's like, rah.
Crocodile doesn't care.
All these people get eaten by mountain lions in California, remember, for years.
Yeah.
And they go, don't shoot them, don't shoot them. They were like eating women in their backyards.
While they were jogging.
Finally, they start killing them and they stop doing it.
Yeah, because they realize there's a consequence and they move on.
You don't see mountain lions eating people in Texas. Unless you're down in Big Bend where they know everybody's disarmed. They go to the gun-free zone.
Yeah, exactly.
The mountain lions go to the gun-free zone to eat people. I've seen one on our ranch in East Texas and one in my backyard in Dripping Springs. ran off where I get a photo, but they don't attack people there because they're scared.
We're getting coyotes. In my neighborhood, we've got coyotes.
That's in the middle of Austin.
Yeah. I've seen them running around because they run through the canals. They've used the canals.
You've got to get low velocity 22 that you don't hear. Just take them out.
Yeah. And they do it at night, and they're
target.
I saw one running. I'm like, that's a big cat. Whoa, it's a freaking coyote. I saw it turn its head.
We've reached the shield generator, my lord. You may start your landing. Hour 4, 70 seconds away at Infowars.com/show. If you're watching this transmission or listening to it, GCN, you're the resistance. Touching the end of his nose, that means he's brought his intellect into hyperwarp. Yes. There he is. His Britannic Majesty, Your Majesty. These guys are going to ride shotgun with you 20 minutes into the hour. So am I, Paul. But I know you've got a lot to talk about. I bet Milo, that has been banned off Twitter and banned from speaking in Florida by the police because he was going to speak out against the Muslims that just killed a whole bunch of gay people. I mean, I tell you, we predicted they'd bring him in, let him attack, and then do this, and they're really doing it. Paul Joseph Watson, what else is coming up in the next hour?
Well, we're going to talk about Milo's suspension. He's actually back on Twitter now because there was such a huge deluge of complaints. Drudge linked it, big fat red link at the top.
But it shows, why would they even try it?
Well, I think what happened was he got mass reported by Arab Twitter. So it was basically a huge frothing mass outrage campaign because he posted...
People that want to throw gays off buildings, but... Because yeah, they can't do that quite yet to Milo. They just wanted to shut down his free speech.
Yeah, they're progressive. So he put up a poll saying, what do we want in the West? Women, gays, freedom, or Islam? And at the start of the poll, it was, you know, 95% women, gays, freedom. Then Arab Twitter got a hold of it. This Islamist with 1.2 million followers put it up. So it swung back to like 60-40. And then they just reported him. He was suspended for about 30 minutes, and the backlash was so intensive that he was back within the hour. So that just shows you how much power.
But when they did it to that other lady, they haven't let her come back yet. I mean, they're noticed a lot of people. They've done it to us.
Well, no, and the second largest shareholder in Twitter, a bigger shareholder than Jack Dorsey, the founder, is a Saudi prince. You know, the people who like to execute homosexuals. So we can't have any criticism
of them. Women.
Now 20% of Hillary's campaign is funded by the people who still execute homosexuals, but they're progressive, they're liberal, they're trendy.
And also I had a psychiatrist on about this yesterday, top psych warfare expert, and he was saying, but homosexuality is like ubiquitous in especially Wahhabist or Sunni Islam. So it's like, but they don't call it that. It's like weird. They like, they're doing it constantly, but if they decide they want to kill you for it, then they do. Just like this guy, as I predicted Sunday, was always in the gay bar. He was on, you know, these apps like Grindr out there doing this and like hitting on everybody, but then separately went and killed him.
No, I mean, that's the thing over and over again. They're complete hypocrites. It seems the more radical their beliefs, the more hypocritical they are. That's why, you know, for example, the 9/11 hijackers drank before the attacks. And, you know, my cousin's gay. He knows some of the people who move in these circles. And it's a total open secret. It's well known. All these Saudis, all these princes, all these billionaires come to London to have gay orgies. That's their preferred activity. And yet when they go back home, they will whip people. They will imprison people. They will execute people simply for having, you know, gay relationships. When they're doing the same thing, they're coming over to Europe having these gay orgies. So it's no surprise that the Orlando gunman turned out to be that way. Total hypocrite.
Yeah, it's like these preachers you always hear that are saying, you know, put prostitutes in prison and everything, and then they're the ones you catch with the hooker.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the more radical their beliefs are, the more sick they are. So why would they stick to those beliefs? Why would they even be authentic in their beliefs?
But let's go further. We're going to come back and talk about this. Why then is the liberal gay community worshiping Islam, Paul?
Well, what's interesting, since this massacre on Saturday night, a lot of them have come out and said that they're voting for Trump. In fact, I'm going to cover that in an article later.
But now there's censorship of the gays for Trump hashtag.
Yeah, this is on Twitter. Again, remember, Google was censoring Hillary Clinton criminal. They made it about the 94 crime bill instead of all her scandals. Now gays for Trump hashtag is being censored. It does not auto complete despite the fact that it's more than twice as popular as LGBTQ hate Trump party hashtag, which does autocomplete, despite the fact that less than half the number of people...
Stay there. We're going to talk about it when we come back.
Welcome back to the fourth hour of Overdrive of the Alex Jones Show. This is Rob Dew. We got Josh Owens riding shotgun. We got Paul Joseph Watson back in England. This is actually a reunion. We left Paul a couple days ago, about 4 a.m. From our hotel in Prague, where we were flying out. So we're going to, I guess, wrap up a little bit of Bilderberg business. It was interesting. It was like peaking. The interest was peaking, and then this Orlando shooting happened, and, you know, the world's eye went to this.
Well, I think we hit the highlight, which was Petraeus, you chasing Petraeus. That was the highlight of the trip, because that's what we're there to do. We're not there to sit outside and, you know, hang out and be friendly. Not that there's a problem with that, but we're there to cover what's going on inside because the media isn't covering it.
Exactly. And there were a lot of issues. And we actually, I actually heard some audio. I'm waiting for that to come in. But I'll talk about that in 1 second. But just to let you guys know, Tim Kennedy was on the show today, and we launched the Tim Kennedy special, 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. I actually brought Brain Force and Secret 12 along with the iodine and silver that I never leave home without. I even took it to Europe. And I, you know, bring a little bit extra so I can give to my buddies out there. As part of our partnership with Special Forces operator and UFC fighter Tim Kennedy, we're giving you up to 15% off of InfoWars Life formulas used by Tim Kennedy. So you get 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 for a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com. These are the products Tim uses in his Special Forces and UFC training to help get him to the next level. All three products have hundreds of five-star reviews and contain known herbs that help boost my vitality and help the body naturally. So, also, Living Defense is almost sold out. This is also another great product to get rid of the parasites that may be lurking inside your body. So, go to InfoWarsLife.com, check out the Tim Kennedy special and Living Defense. So, Paul, what were your final impressions of Bilderberg ending it this year? We definitely, in terms of Drudge support, we got a lot of Drudge love, which was nice, especially on the some of those videos of these people leaving and not wanting to answer any questions. They pretend, you know, reporters don't exist, but if they're in any other location, they would stop and give a statement, you know. What's your take, Paul?
Well, I mean, it's interesting that on their official website, which they only created a few years ago after being in existence for decades, they said that there was no press conference at any Bilderberg meetings because of lack of interest. Now, how is it it's only lack of interest from the mainstream media? I mean, it caught fire on the internet. As you said, we were on Drudge every day, sometimes twice a day. People are really interested in this. And the intersectionality of Brexit and the migrant crisis and the fact that it was in Germany piqued the interest even more. So that's no longer an excuse for them. Henry de Castries, one of the chairman of Bilderberg, basically, came out the day afterwards and said that Brexit possibility is extremely high. So that's what they were talking about. We knew they were talking about that. They were incredibly concerned about that. And overall impressions of Bilderberg were that we blew it wide open once again. We tried to put some of these people on the record. We did in the case of Peter Thiel. He gave some bizarre, mealy-mouthed explanation about comparing us to the Stasi.
Yeah.
So because this huge... a bureaucratic state operation that surveilled people, that hired people as informants, was a bad thing back in the 70s and 80s in East Germany. He then compared us to that simply for asking for transparency.
And those radical transparency. Right.
And those were the leaders back then who were doing that to their people. He was trying to say, what you guys are doing is like the Stasi. Like, we're acting like Stasi. It was crazy. Although we did, I did have to chase Petraeus down because he wouldn't stop and answer my question. And I thought that was pretty interesting. I even did a version with cut it to Chariots of Fire, which maybe we'll play that going out to break. Y'all could play a little bit of that, maybe the last minute, and we'll go to break. But that was just serendipitous. I happened to be interviewing a guy. He was getting bested by the cops. He had three cops around him because he was drawing with chalk on the sidewalk. So I'm in the middle of a 5-minute interview, and all of a sudden I see Petraeus run by, and I'm like, that's it. That's what I was looking for. That's my big fish. And, you know, chased him down, asking him about Hillary Clinton's email server, because he had to resign as a result of his email getting hacked because he was a CIA director. Here's the Secretary of State who had her email continuously hacked. Guccifer was reading out her emails to people, yet, you know, she has to do nothing. It's okay for her.
No, I mean, it was a great effort, given all the equipment you were carrying to keep up with him, because for his age, he's really fast. He's really athletic.
He's very new.
So that was probably the biggest confrontation in, visually in terms of the entire Bilderberg conference. But most interesting one for me was the very first, when we got, you know, as a result of Tillman and his great help, we got the governor of Saxony, Tillich, on record to basically admit that it was a huge lobbying organization. And that's key, because the media always presents it as a talking shop. You know, they say no consensus is achieved, no decisions are made, despite previous Bilderberg members going on record and saying that they do arrive at the consensus, which they then implement in policy. But Tillich brazenly admitted that he was going there to get investment into Dresden. So he was asking all these corporate heads for money to invest into his city.
And that seems like an ancillary property of Bilderberg, Paul. Like, you know, they bring in these local guys and they kind of beg for money a little bit. We confronted him outside, myself and Mr. Tillman. He didn't want to answer any questions, but we had a guy on the inside, another local who, you know, I put out a call for help, and man, the locals responded. They came out in droves and said, hey, I've got a tip. I know where migrant camps are. I know where this is. You know, and this guy, Max, got in on the inside and told him he was doing a school project on Bilderberg. And the guy's like, sure, I'll answer a couple of your questions. And he asked him a couple of innocuous ones. He's like, well, I'm trying to get money for my city of Dresden. And he acted like that was okay to go talk to these people, and we need to do it in secret. And it's just amazing how all that, you know, came out. That, and that was our first big blow before the conference, the night that people were arriving there. That's when that happened. And that feels like 2 years ago already, because so much goes on. But you have to be on your toes. You have to be ready. I got a phone call that says, hey, he's still in the church. We could go confront him. And then our buddy had already got him on the inside. So it's about putting that information out, getting it up as quick as possible. But I think that really blows open the whole myth that Bilderberg's just a private meeting. There's giant banking combines going there, along with politicians and leaders in tech. And they're all trying to figure out a way that they can use the money that they've stolen by, you know, manipulating interest rates and manipulating all these processes that they own to get money for their little pet projects. So this guy in Dresden is probably offering them sweetheart deals to invest. Hey, you come here. I'll give you the best deal because I know you and I met you at Bilderberg. So that's how the club works. You come in, and it is. It's just a little, all, you know, a boys club. You know, in a sense, and you know, they invite media people there, and they're not doing anything about it. I think they bring the media there just to prove that they can do it, and they won't say a word about it. Josh, what do you think?
Yeah, well, it's obvious that they're having meetings inside, or maybe they send out a little newsletter beforehand because Tillich hadn't gone in yet. But you see, when Peter Thiel came out, and the only comment he had was, "Well, the Stasi was in favor of radical transparency." Whatever the hell that means, I have no idea. But they obviously get these talking points because I'm assuming that the low-level people, when they get there, the people that have never been there before, they see this big crowd of people protesting. And I'm sure they have to ask themselves, well, what's going on? Why are they so upset that we're in here? And so I'm sure they give out, you know, little newsletters. I'm sure they give a little card that's like, oh, it's okay that we're meeting in secret. It's good that we're meeting in secret. So I think it's interesting that a few of the people, that's the only comment they had to make, Tillich and Thiel. Yeah. That was the only thing they had to say, was that, well, you know what? It's okay that we meet in secret. In fact, it's good. Let me give you some double think so we can say that it's actually part of the Nazis that we want transparency.
Yeah, you're now a Nazi because you want to know what's going on. So... Well, Paul, I think we're going to punch out here. Let's go to that video with Chariots of Fire chasing Petraeus, and maybe we'll put it on InfoWars right now. It's just on my personal channel because of the because I'm using that amazing score from the movie from the 1980s. So with that, Paul's going to come back after the break. This is Rob Dew, Josh Owens. I guess signing off for Bilderberg. We may have one other extra video that we're going to put up, an amazing interview we did with someone who claims to be related to a Bilderberg member, one of the founding members. So that should be interesting. I don't know if we totally believe her yet, though. So let's roll that video.
One quick question, General Petraeus. You had to resign as a result of an email scandal, yet Hillary Clinton is still running for president, even though she's got this massive email scandal with people hacking her. Do you think she should resign from the Democratic Party? Just one quick question, sir.
Now there's a story out of Denton which has broken in the last few hours. A man holding a Quran, ranting about Allah and making terrorist threats, was arrested at a Texas courthouse. Peshwaz Azad Waisi, 28, was arrested Wednesday morning at the Denton County Courthouse on East McKinney Street on charges that he made terroristic threats. So he's holding a Quran, he's ranting about Allah, he's making terrorist threats. I guess that's nothing to do with Islam. We have yet another story. Islamic refugee with gas pipeline plans arrested in New Mexico border county. This is out of Judicial Watch. Police in a U.S. town bordering Mexico have apprehended an undocumented Middle Eastern woman in possession of the region's gas pipeline plans. Law enforcement sources tell Judicial Watch authorities describe the woman as an Islamic refugee. I'm sure bringing more cultural enrichment. Pulled over during a traffic stop by a deputy sheriff in Luna County, New Mexico, which shares a 54-mile border with Mexico. County authorities alerted the U.S. Border Patrol and the FBI and the Joint Terrorism Task Force. So again, another other than Mexican sneaking around down there on the border with gas pipeline plans, a Middle Eastern woman, an Islamic refugee, which again goes to the heart of this debate about the border and the wall. This isn't just about Mexicans. This isn't just about illegal aliens. It's about ISIS. We know we've had reports of ISIS camps down there on the border in the past, and this is an open sieve through which they can come and wreak the kind of havoc that we saw in Orlando, Florida. And remember, if you actually look at the evidence, there's no way this guy could have done this on his own. You know, the amount of ammo alone he would have had to carry, the audio out of the gay club itself, you know, 30 rounds being shot in a matter of a couple of seconds, the eyewitness reports of multiple shooters. Now, I'm not saying that it's a government false flag. What I'm saying is that this was more than likely a cell of ISIS jihadists that carried out this brutal attack. And you can compare it to the Bataclan incident, of course, in Paris. You know, 80-plus people killed in that attack, not even double the amount. They had several individuals involved in that attack. They had more time in which to carry it out. They had more targets. They had a bigger arena. They didn't have a dingy, small little nightclub. So this stinks to high heaven. Basically, there's a cover-up going on. There were reports of the authorities looking to arrest other people. There was a report they were about to arrest someone. That's all been buried now. And again, it's this lone wolf perspective. Because if they allow that narrative to be expanded outside of one lone wolf, then it stops becoming about gun control, the Second Amendment. And they have to acknowledge that it's about Islamic terrorism. And in fact, Stefan Molyneux did an interesting interview with Mike Cernovich yesterday, former military guy, of course. And, you know, he's coming out with a lot of that evidence. So I urge you to go and watch that video. But again, it stinks to high heaven. There were multiple shooters by the sounds of things, and they're covering it up so as to hide the fact that we have ISIS terror cells inside America. And the next attack is coming soon. Because Obama not only refuses to deal with the problem, refuses to even use the term radical Islamic terrorism. And we're going to get more into that after the break. But of course, I'm here in Britannia. We've got the big Brexit vote coming up next week. And Nigel Farage got on a boat, sailed down the Thames today. He was countered by people like Bob Geldof, the millionaire hypocrite, the champagne socialist, who is, of course, supporting to remain in the EU. And Geldof, and you can see this on my Twitter feed, actually stuck two fingers up at the fishermen who were on the pro-leave boat. So you have poor working-class fishermen whose lives have been destroyed, ruined by these EU fishing quotas that force them to destroy their own boats, in fact, pay them to do so, because they're not allowed to fish in their own waters. Completely decimated the fishing industry in Britain. So they're there protesting on a boat, sailing down the River Thames, and Bob Geldof, a champagne socialist, is there screaming vulgarities at them. And even the pro-Remain, the pro-EU people on that boat with Geldof, left. because even they were disgusted at his behavior. So you've got a virtue signaling champagne socialist lecturing poor working class fishermen when they're the ones who are having their careers, their livelihoods, their very heritage destroyed. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show after the break. Don't go away. So you have champagne socialist Bob Geldof, the biggest virtue signaling hypocrite on the planet, on a boat on the River Thames in London, gesturing, making vulgar statements, insulting these poor fishermen who are voting to leave the European Union because their livelihoods, their jobs, their industry has been completely decimated by the EU common fisheries policy, which means that, you know, Norwegian boats, Dutch boats can fish in British waters just a few miles off the coast in places like, you know, Newcastle up in the north of England. So, of course, the British fishermen are going to go out and protest. They're going to vote leave. And if you want to vote remain and remain in a tyranny that creates over 60% of British laws and regulations without the British people even having a say in that protest, if you like dictatorship, then I guess that's your democratic choice. I mean, people voted for Hitler, right? They voted him into power. That's your choice. But to see Bob Geldof, again, a multimillionaire, a guy who is a complete fraud, a guy who came out at the start of the refugee crisis and said, I will house Syrian refugees on my own personal property. How many Syrian refugees did he house? The same number as Saudi Arabia? Zero, none, because it's all BS. It's all hot air to make himself look good. Because he's a virtue signaler. He doesn't actually care about refugees. So now he's on a boat in London, leering at, gesturing at, sticking two fingers up, insulting these working class fishermen. And as I said, even the pro-Remain people who were on his side, the Labour people, left the boat. Even they were disgusted by his behaviour. So again, this is completely blowing up in their faces. The polls over the last 2 weeks have shown a huge shift towards the Leave campaign. And again, this is huge. This is a complete repudiation of the globalist agenda that they've painstakingly tried to build for decades. Bilderberg back in the 50s, creating the euro. You know, Etienne Davignon admitting back in 2009 that the euro single currency was a project of the Bilderberg Group. This is global government. This is taking away power from the people, our democratic will, coalescing it, centralizing it into this federalized tyranny, this bureaucracy, represented by the EU Commission, which both creates and passes laws. The Parliament is completely ceremonial. The EU Parliament cannot vote down laws. It has no actual power. So that's what the pro-Remain camp will be voting for. Shackles and chains. And that's their choice. But to see this champagne socialist engaging in this kind of behavior, directing it towards these fishermen who have had their livelihoods destroyed, absolutely vile, disgusting. But it's no surprise coming from someone like Bob Geldof, who is a supreme hypocrite like no other. And on that same subject, again, if you go to my Twitter feed, which is at Prison Planet, there's a picture there of London's new Muslim mayor, Sadiq Khan, who, of course, was elected after sharing a platform with an ISIS supporter 9 times. You know, once might have been a mistake, but 9 times, of course. He was criticized for doing that by David Cameron. Just a few weeks later, David Cameron was out campaigning alongside Sadiq Khan because they both support Britain remaining in the EU. So he's out there giving a speech for the pro-Remain campaign today, surrounded by, you can picture, probably like 2 white people, the rest are Muslims. That's his constituency, after all. In Tooting, which is not far from where I live, which you can go on Google Maps and look at it, you know, there's a mosque, there's a halal butcher, there's an Islamic bookstore, And there's not much else. It's one of those areas that has had this cultural enrichment, as many others have. But look at this picture. Go onto my Twitter feed. It's him giving a speech. He's surrounded by people. You will notice the people around him at the front are all men, Muslim men. The people at the back are all Muslim women, because segregation is liberal. Segregation is trendy. And we've seen this at past Labour events. They will have Muslim women on one side of the room and all the men on the other side of the room, because they can't mix. And that's progressive. So again, he's campaigning for Remain. And in this very image, you see everything that's wrong with Islam, everything that's wrong with him being the mayor of London. Let's move on, though, because, of course, we had the horrific events on Saturday night in Orlando, Florida. And we've got the leftist media response, which is always to make apologies for Islam, the religion of peace. This article is up on Infowars.com. Regressive left blames conservative Christians for Orlando massacre, argues that white Americans inspire more violence against LGBT community than radical Islamists. Yeah, right, because one single incident on Saturday night killed more gay people than decades and decades of supposed LGBT hate from the Christian right. Not that that's a good thing, but if you want to talk about violence, that one incident wiped it out completely in terms of the numbers. In a backwards twist of logic, regressive leftists have pinned the blame for the shooting at a gay nightclub in Orlando by a Muslim extremist who declared allegiance with ISIS, nothing to do with Islam, on conservative Christians. Writing for Think Progress, LGBT editor Zach Ford outlined his mind-bending theory that conservative Christian America is to blame for the massacre in two ways. Now, one of those ways is the fact that James Wesley Howell, this guy who was found in Indiana with guns and explosives and chemicals in his car, was on the way to a California gay pride parade. So that and he was white. So that proves that this Islamic terror attack was the fault of white Christians. Didn't care to mention the fact that the guy who was caught in Indiana was a gay man. That completely was omitted from the article. So he's basically saying, given that even so-called moderate Muslims support killing people, Ford also fails to mention that Howell is not a conservative Christian, as I said. He's in fact a gay man. Howell's ex-boyfriend and other acquaintances were interviewed by reporters and maintained Howell harbored no violent feelings towards the LGBT community. So again, his argument is completely eviscerated on that score alone. But this is the rhetoric that we're seeing in the aftermath. The rampant apologia for radical Islam every single time. Because, you know, as Milo Yiannopoulos said, the left has made its choice. It cares more about protecting the feelings of Muslims than protecting the lives of gay people. And part of that process is to deny that within Islam there's a violent hatred towards gay people, which is an admitted fact. 11 Muslim countries still execute gay people. Where is the leftist outrage about that? Well, it's non-existent, because in the oppression Olympics, Muslims rank above gays. And God forbid, somebody might call them Islamophobic. Somebody might call them racist, even though Islam is not a race. So I did a flashback article this morning, which is posted on Infowars.com and got linked up on the Drudge Report. Islamic speaker admits killing gays is a belief held by moderate Muslims. In light of the massacre of dozens of people at a gay club in Orlando, it's worth revisiting the comments of Islamic speaker Fared Qureshi, and this is in Norway, who admitted that the desire to see homosexuals killed was a belief held by so-called moderate Muslims. Now, this is in Norway. It's in a Western country. He's up there giving a speech in front of a packed house full of Western so-called moderate Muslims. He asked them if they support the execution of gay people as prescribed in the Quran, And if you're watching the live video stream on Infowars.com, you will see their reaction. But I'll talk to you about it after. Here's the clip.
Can we have this camera focusing on all the audience here? Can we have this camera focusing on all the audience? Because every now and then, every time we have a conference, every time we invite a speaker, they always can come with the same accusations. This speaker supports death penalty for homosexuals. This speaker supports death penalty for this crime or this crime or that. He is homophobic. They subjugate women, etc., etc., etc. It's the same old stuff coming all the time. And we always try to tell them, I always try to tell them that, look, it's not that speaker that we're inviting who has these extreme radical views, as you say. These are general views that every Muslim actually has. Every Muslim believes in these things. Just because they're not telling you about it, or just because they're not out there in the media, doesn't mean they don't believe in them. So I will ask you, everyone in the room, how many of you are normal Muslims? You're not extremist, you're not radical, this is normal Sunni Muslims. Please raise your hands. Everybody, mashallah, subhanallah. Okay, take down your hands again. How many of you agree that men and women should sit separate? Please raise your hands.
Sisters in particular.
Everyone agree, brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. So it's not just these radical sheikhs then. Allahu Akbar. Next question. How many of you agree that the punishments described in the Quran and the Sunnah, whether it is death, whether it is stoning for adultery, whatever it is, if it is from Allah and His Messenger, that is the best punishment ever possible for humankind, and that is what we should apply in the world? Who agrees with that? Allahu Akbar. Are you all the radical extremists? Subhanallah. So all of you are saying that you are common Muslims, you all go to the different masajids, no way? Or are you like a specific sect, like the Islamnet sect or anything like that? Are you like that? No. Are you like that? Please raise your hand if you like this extreme Islamnet sect or anything like that. No one. Allahu Akbar. How many of you just go to these normal masajids in Norway, the normal Sunni mosques? Please raise your hands. Allahu Akbar. So what's the politicians gonna say now? What's the media gonna say now? That we're all extremists? We're all radicals? We need to deport all of us from this country? Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. Takbir! 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 May we have the next question, please?
Right there again. He's up there complaining about the media characterizing Muslims who have these beliefs that homosexuals should be killed as extremist Muslims. So then he asks this huge crowd of so-called moderate Muslims, do they share this belief that homosexuals should be killed, that women should be stoned to death for adultery? They all put their hands up. White, black, Arab, doesn't matter. They all put their hands up. And then he says, look, this is not extremists that believe this. This is a normal Muslim belief. And all these so-called westernized Muslims, Norway in this case, share those same beliefs. So again, that leftist trope that it's a tiny minority of radical fringe extremists that have these beliefs is complete bunkum. And you saw the poll out of the United Kingdom 2 months ago. 52% of Muslims think that homosexuality should be illegal. You can look at the Pew polls out of the Middle East of those who believe in Sharia law. The majority agree that homosexuals should be executed. This isn't about jihadists. This isn't about extremists. This is about Islam. This is what they actually believe. But the left refuses to call it out because they care more about protecting the feelings of Muslims than the lives of gay people. And you can look at the preacher, the cleric there in Orlando, who just weeks before Omar Mateen's rampage was calling for gays to be executed, quote, out of compassion. This is his quote. Death is the sentence. There's nothing to be embarrassed about this. Death is the sentence. That's what he said about homosexual people. This is a so-called moderate cleric out of Orlando. So again, no surprise that we've had numerous gay people, numerous homosexual groups who have come out in the aftermath of this and have switched their allegiance to Trump and away from the likes of Hillary Clinton, 20% of her campaign being funded by Saudi Arabia, a country that still executes gays, that whips them, that puts them in prison. So this is out of the Inquisitor. Donald Trump gets LGBT support boost after Orlando shooting. Donald Trump appears to have lured a growing number of LGBT voters away from his Democratic challenger, Hillary Clinton, funded by Saudi Arabia, who kill gay people. Trump's speech after the Orlando shooting by self-avowed ISIS terrorists has earned him the steadfast loyalty of gay Americans, who are now keenly focused on national security, immigration, and terrorism matters. And remember, the people who throw gays off buildings in the Middle East, they're not inspired to do so by Western foreign policy. Again, that was the justification trotted out in the aftermath of this massacre, because the gunman said that it was a retribution, that the West should stop bombing ISIS. Well, ISIS throws gay people off buildings in the Middle East. They throw Syrian people off buildings. They're not Westerners, they're Syrian. And the people watching in the crowds below do absolutely nothing. They sit back and enjoy the show. Which is not to say that a lot of these populations are living under absolute tyranny, and just to survive they have to go along with this. But again, they're throwing Middle Easterners off buildings. They're not just killing Westerners. So again, this trope that everything is somehow justified as a reaction to Western foreign policy, complete BS. 11 countries, as a matter of law, throughout the Islamic world still execute gay people. The left has absolutely nothing to say about it because they're hypocrites and they place Muslims above gays in the oppression Olympics. We'll be back with the final segment and more news after the break. InfoWars. We're back on the final segment of the Alex Jones Show live. We're not going to get a chance to go to the video, but 6 months ago I put out a video, Islam is not a religion of peace, going through all these arguments, and it's more relevant than ever before, so I urge you to go and watch that video. Let's hit on some final few news stories here with 4 minutes left on the show. Reuters, half of likely voters back temporary ban on all Muslim entry to the United States. New polling data from Reuters shows a surge in support for a far-reaching temporary ban on any Muslim entry to the United States. In the wake of the terrorist attack in Orlando, 50% of likely voters now support a temporary halt on Muslim entry into the US. Just 42% of likely voters oppose a temporary ban. So now it's shifted in majority favor of people supporting that ban. The finding represents a 22-point swing since the beginning of the month. At the end of May, just 40% of likely voters support a halt, while 54% opposed one. So this poll was taken, I believe, immediately after the terrorist attack in Orlando. And Donald Trump's policy of a temporary limit on Muslim immigration is proving more popular. More people support it than those who oppose it amongst likely voters. This is out of Breitbart. US resettles million migrants from countries that execute gays. Oh, more cultural enrichment. Between 2001 and 2014, the United States has permanently resettled nearly 750,000 migrants from nations that may execute gays and lesbians, including 250,000 who were resettled during Hillary Clinton's tenure in the State Department. As Secretary of State, Clinton was in charge of screening visas for admission, which some foreign nationals could then adjust to receive green cards. So now we've got these people pouring into the United States. But again, don't worry. They're going to integrate. They're going to settle. They're going to get jobs. They're not going to hate gay people. Everything's fine. Let's just ignore the fact that they're going to mosques every week where clerics are telling them that killing gay people is perfectly acceptable. This is out of Sky News. Muslim cleric leaves Australia over anti-gay remarks. A Muslim cleric who suggested that homosexuals be put to death has left Australia ahead of his visa being cancelled. British-born Farouk Shellafar arrived in Sydney last Tuesday as the guest speaker of an Islamic centre in Sydney. He said, quote, death is the sentence for gay sex acts in public. Again, the left has nothing whatsoever to say about that. Now, with the Brexit vote, which I talked about earlier in the show, the EU time and time again has ignored the democratic will of the European people. They had votes for the EU constitution, the Lisbon Treaty, in countries like France, in the Netherlands, other countries, Ireland, where they voted to reject the EU's mandate every single time. Well, now, politicians in Britain are preparing to reject the democratic will of the British people, even if we vote to leave the EU. This is out of Business Insider. There's an incredible theory that a Brexit won't actually happen, even if the public votes for it. Well, it's not a theory. You know, I've been saying this could happen for weeks now. A really crucial detail about the upcoming EU referendum has gone virtually unmentioned, and it is probably the most crucial detail. Parliament doesn't actually have to bring Britain out of the EU, even if the public votes for it. So there's this technicality within the process of the referendum, which says it's just a referendum, it's not legally binding. So even if we vote leave, which the polls show might happen now, they're going to go back to Parliament, they're going to try and steal that vote on a technicality. Let them go ahead and do that. They're threatening economic terrorism now, and the British people just aren't going to put up with it. That's the show. InfoWars Nightly News tonight. Alex will be back 11 to 2 tomorrow. Breaking news at InfoWars.com.